deal. When it come across this young man sawing on a fiddle and playing it high, and a devil jumps up on Hickory Stump still.
Boy, let me tell you what. Guess you didn't know it, but I'm a fiddle player too. And if you care to take it there, I'll make a bet with you. You play a pretty good fiddle, son, but if the devil is due, I bet a fiddle of gold against you, so I think I'm better than you.
Boy, said,
my name's Johnny, and it might be a sin, but I'll take your bet, and you're gonna regret I'm the best it's ever been.
Johnny, rock up your bow and play your fiddle hard. Cause hell broke loose in your day, and the devil deals the card. And if you win, you get this shiny fiddle made of gold. But if you lose, it will get your soul.
Case and said,
I'll start this show.
Fire flew from his fingertips as he rising up the bow. He dragged the bow across the strings and it made an evil hiss. Then a band of demons joined in and it sounded something like this.
Okay. Alright. Hello, everybody. Sports Goofs number 204. I'm Francisco, joined by my buddies Andrew and Charles here for, well, it'll be an interesting episode. It's been a bit, but some things have happened. We are, well, the storm's over. I'm going to turn off this rain here. The storm is over. Hurricane Milton just passed through. I was down here in my end, guys, and I just had my power go out at 2 a.m., and I got it back by 11, so slept through, but luckily the AC was running, so before that, and I had enough cool air to last me, and luckily it was still cloudy and everything, so I didn't really feel the too much of the effects of losing power there. That was mine. That was like the worst of it for me. My sister didn't lose any power, but my dad was staying with her, and I just stayed here with the dogs and my mom out here. But how about you guys?
I surprisingly didn't lose like anything. I'm stunned. you know, it got windy to be sure. It was a lot of rain, but you know, I was fully expecting to lose power. You know, I got sandbags ready to go. I guess technically they were dirt bags, but That just kind of sounds weird to say. I set the AC real low. Again, I was fully expecting to lose power. Had lanterns everywhere, flashlights, what have you, but nothing. I'm just baffled because this is two straight storms in a row where, you know, Helene, we were expecting tropical storm force winds. We got 2 days off of work. Not a direct hit, mind you, but we were expecting decent stuff. We didn't get anything, basically. And then this one, for sure, but I'm just very lucky, very fortunate. You know, I know folks on the West Coast were not so lucky. Heck, even people on the East Coast were not so lucky because you had massive tornadoes.
Got some down here where I'm at, but I didn't see anything. But closest was one in Wellington, so it's
that was
the most that I saw here.
There was one within a view of Amerant Bank Arena. I was born in Oklahoma. I grew up in Oklahoma. I've seen tornadoes. You know, those things are legit. You know, they'll rip away a house. The stuff that we get in Florida normally really is not that strong. And then especially with storms that come out of a hurricane, those are just kind of real. I mean, tornadoes in hurricanes are common just by the spinning nature of the storm. But they're usually pretty weak, pretty quick. Don't last that long, don't cause all that much damage. This one was insane. The National Weather Service already preliminary rated a tornado that hit Palm Beach Gardens in EF3, which is nuts. You know, I'll go on a rant later off show, I guess, but to have an EF3 in Florida is just absolutely mind-boggling, let alone one that came out of a hurricane. So it's, this whole storm was just unreal. And then, you know, I'm just lucky that the worst of it, we didn't get it.
All right. I am not Jim Cantor. I never really sweat on hurricanes. You can't control it. You just prep for it. But I was in Georgia, hint, hint, the title of the episode. So I was able to get cases of water, and I texted my parents on Saturday because I'm very proactive with this. Why? Because you got to take care of your people, and I have my family, and then I have my coworkers who I'm always kind of strategizing on, and I was kind of eyeing it. And the thing to know about this versus that is that with hurricanes, it needs to swell a little bit, right? And because of the pace I was moving, it was slowing down a little bit, and we're in October, so it wasn't dealing with, like, August humidity, which would have scared me. But, you know, I was like, all right, F it, we'll do it live. So made sure to kind of like stock up ahead because I'm 35. I am probably the closest man child that you guys know, more Peter Pan than Charles Trujillo, right? Sometimes more Peter Parker, right? But when it comes to hurricanes, I don't play out because I am very much a person who uses internet a lot, whether it be screw around on the Twitter, false on Twitter, Charles the True, Dan Frijoles, FJOJR, Junior, and then Sports Underscore Goose, Panther Historians, nice and going.
Oh, it's popping.
Fear the Pegasus,
popping, popping the other day.
Arlen's Historian, not so much, and I don't do anything else Twitter because I'm too lazy to do it. But I always kind of like to keep prepared, so I have picked up a lot of chips, tons of chips, even in Georgia. I picked up, you know, the family picked up bread and peanut butter because I'll live like I lived in FIU, man. All you got to do is just give me peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, and that's fine. I just want to know when the gym was closing. I didn't care. I was remote the last 2 days. And then, of course, I know Andrew does not partake. I know Francisco does really partake. But when you have a 72-year-old father, a 60-year-old mother, and a lot of pets and a dog who's 13 with anxiety, I had to get that Hennessy. You know what I'm saying? Like, I knocked that out, and I was getting game. I gamed a lot. But
yeah,
damage-wise, I really did. I beat Cyberpunk DLC, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. Sad ending if you go one route. I have problems with RPGs. I just have a combo on that. But we weren't hit that badly. It's just your typical, you know, tree branch brush debris and the fronds. My paralegal, he got hit with a tornado on his street, and he showed me some of the damage. He has no power. So tomorrow I'm going to send him some food or DoorDash or something like that. He's going to hate me for it. But I don't care. We love you, Derek. But, you know, I said this last week. I'm going to use this platform again. For like the one or two people who listen to us, or somebody who's new going there, donate to whatever relief you are. I'm not asking you to donate $100. I'm asking you to donate $5, $10, because that could be kind of like a difference that kind of comes in whatever charitable fashion. I don't care if it's a GoFundMe. I don't care if it's Red Cross. I don't care if it's to whatever, because the thing is, it does take a village, because you already got places that are impacted by Helene. I have some friends in the Carolinas and I've seen some of the damage there. And you're talking about, you know, West Florida, and you know, we're all pricks, and I get that. And we're supposed to be, there's a survival instinct, but you never know when someone else is going to help you. So my little rant is like, yeah, I turned out okay, but there's people who literally didn't. There's, you know, there was a lot of tornadoes actually in this hurricane near where I lived. And I'm like about 35 minutes from Francisco, so I'm about 30 or 45, so I'm about 30 miles north of him. And then 30 miles north of me is St. Lucie, the predominant area where I work. And I think one of the animal shelters.
Yeah, they got hit hard up there.
And you guys don't understand. There's a lot of bureaucracy. And we all know my government opinions outside of our group settings. And that's why it might be contributed to help people in some capacity. Because sometimes we have to take away the ego, kill it, and just, you know, acknowledge a person. You might not know them, they might not owe you anything, but there's plenty of people that you interact with that are family or friends, and you've given them some money and they end up using that for the wrong reasons and they suck. Give $10. Don't eat Taco Bell for a week. That's all I can say about that. I'm okay. I'm alive. I wasn't really concerned. I also live in a 950 square foot, you know, household. So if I did, and I was under tornado watch for a bit, if it was going to happen, it was going to happen. You know what I mean? I told my family jokes, and I'm going to say this to you guys. If you found me dead, you know what I'm clutching on to. My OLED, I'm clutching on to Ramona, my Switch, my PlayStation 5, and my birth certificate. Because I, you know, long story short, my back in the 89 days, Trujillo was Trigillo by New York because they don't care. And my mother had corrected a pen and it prevented me from getting like a license later on the line. So those are things. My title belts are at the office. So I said, if I went, bury me with the WWE, give Derek the big gold. but I'm okay.
Okay. All right. So, yeah, and just a lot of damage from the storm. I'm actually going to bring this up here on the big screen here. Something that retains one of us at the very least. I'm sure you guys have seen the damage that was done to Tropicana Field.
Yeah.
Home of the Rays.
Like, I attacked the Trop a lot, but it was kind of,
It's sad. It's like we everybody's bashed on the Trop since, I don't know, maybe in the last five to six, seven years now, especially. But I think collectively, I guess baseball as a whole is just like, aw, like that's like sad in comparison.
I mean, Twitter was great though because someone saved the AL wildcard winner banner that they had. I laughed a little bit.
Yeah, exactly. That was kind of funny, but yeah, but it's just it's insane that this thing lasted for like 35 years and nothing like this has ever happened to it. And it's
bear in mind, Tampa has not taken a direct hit from a major hurricane in like 100 something years at least.
Can I ask you something, Andrew? Right after you're done.
No, go ahead.
Don't you think it actually looks better without the dome? Just I saw that skyline thing. I'm like, man, there's some potential here.
I mean,
Florida, nice, beautiful day. You've been down to the Marlins Stadium. It looks nice with the opening.
I mean, it's a waste of money to build a retractable roof.
Mm-hmm.
For a sport that does not play in rain. I mean, I will be honest. I have thought before that the stadium would look nice without a roof. But the logistics are just that it makes no sense to not have a roof. That said, if it had a nicer looking roof, you know, I think it would have look nicer. I don't know. I almost wish that they would have replicated the Trop or replicated some more things about the design, like the angled roof, for example. I love my Trop. She's my baby. You know, it'll be sad to see it go. You know, that's the first park that I went to a baseball game in, a pro baseball game or major league baseball game, that is.
Same.
You know, they have the lights now as Francisco is showing on screen. It was not designed for baseball, but they made it a good baseball facility. And, you know, who knows if the last game has been played at Tropicana Field 3 years earlier than thought. I don't think so. I think...
I don't know what the roof is made out of. I'm not
sure. It's made out of a Teflon material.
Okay.
It did look a little cheap when I saw it getting destroyed.
I mean, remember the same thing sort of happened with the Vikings at the Metrodome, right?
Where the
roof caved in from snow.
True, but the thing about that one, though, was I don't think that one was built to withstand as high of winds as this one, or that much pressure. This was built to withstand 115 mile per hour winds, and there have been plenty of storms that have come through Tampa in that time. but this was just, this was a near worst case scenario. You know, the worst case scenario would have been a Cat 5 that made a direct impact. Well, this one came a little bit south, and it was not a Cat 5.
So, I mean, well, I'm just trying to go on, like, what happens for the upcoming seasons from The Athletic, showing that the stadium engineer is unclear if the roof can even be fixed in time for opening day. So, that's the thing, like, the fabric itself.
Who's going to pay for it?
Because, like, I forgot if the Vikings had to play some interim games at the Golden Gopher Stadium.
For the Vikings.
Yeah, it did. But I don't know if they had to play anything at the Golden Gopher Stadium or if that was like a quick fix of the roof.
Well, it was like November, December, right?
So something like that. I mean, we could look this up, I think. But my thing is, well, what happens if the thing's not ready for opening day? What do you think would happen? Would they play at the Yankees spring training facility there?
They would play at Disney.
Yeah, they would probably play at Disney.
I mean, which is a bigger ballpark though? Yeah, a bigger ballpark near the fan base. I think that would be where the Yanks play.
Well, I mean, but the thing is that could they even loan it out, right? Because you're still going to mid. I mean, Grant, it depends, right? Because minor league games are being played at that juncture.
But you've had like Shea Stadium hosted the Yankees and the Mets for an entire season while they renovated the old Yankee Stadium. It's last iteration. So it's not unheard of for two baseball teams, especially like a minor league team.
Yeah, but that's also kind of like in the same. It's on a pro level. And it's not that far apart, you know, but Yankee Stadium versus, you know, whatever Steinbrenner has in Tampa. Let's ask this question, Andrew. Do you think it's better economically for your team if it's hosted in Disney?
He wants it in Orlando, that's for sure.
I know he does. But the thing is, like, this is one of the few times where I think the meat writing of Orlando actually works for a franchise that's kind of like in a disarray a little bit.
Yeah,
isn't that field and like the spring training is kind of smaller, hasn't been touched up on, all that stuff.
Correct. And you know, another thing to consider is,
okay, so the Vikings in 2010, that's when their roof collapsed.
They played at what is now Huntington Bank Stadium.
So they played in Detroit. That was one game, and then they played the rest at the Golden Gopher Stadium.
Mm-hmm. Gophers, I think, is the college football team.
Yep.
So Tampa, I mean, realistically, yeah, there's no spring training team in the Orlando area as of this moment, right? So,
correct. So, the closest we've got is Detroit over in Lakeland.
Yeah, and then there's all these other minor league teams that play at these spring training facilities. So you have, you know, Lakeland, you've got Tampa, you've got Bradenton, and
contrary Clearwater. To a long conversation for many years ago, no one wants to have a Lakeland team, Andrew.
I mean, that'd be funny. It'd be funny if they did play in Polk County. So just for the narratives of this show at the very least. But I think really those are the two viable venues would be. It's either what, Clearwater or Tampa, right? Where the Yanks play. I think those are like really the only two. I don't think you go any more south than the Braden team. Right?
No,
Orlando.
Orlando, though, I think is the best option. I agree with Andrew on that one. One, because Disney's always going to want the tourism because it saw a lot of venue and, during the COVID season. And
yeah, two, they can make a thing of it, like ESPN like did with the COVID season, right? Like you said, Charles.
Yeah. And I'm sure ownership is going to have some kind of, like, you know, benefit tax-wise where City is going to commission it because right now in those seasons, you only have, like, the Orlando Magic, right? So you don't have an Orlando hockey team. You don't have Orlando football. Yeah, we do.
The Solar Bear. A Major League team.
Major League, I'm sorry. You know, the places that are going to charge you an arm and a leg.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
honestly, I think... I mean, just going away from the logistics of it, you know, I spent a lot of good time in that stadium going to O-Rays games. So it would be nice, you know, that was, and the thing is, they don't use that stadium for anything anymore. The thing is just collecting dust. It's a really nice stadium, though. It's a bummer that no one uses it, because it's legitimately a very nice stadium. So I would not be opposed to them coming to Orlando for
a season,
for
at least half a season.
Right.
May I also confess of why I would want to Orlando?
What's that? Like a
2-hour and 15-minute drive for me to see them versus the Yanks. That's chump change time for me. So compared to like 3.5-4 hours it takes to Tampa.
Yeah.
Right.
And every other year in Miami.
Yeah, I have a vested interest in this, especially because tonight's a big game.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Well, while we're on the topic of baseball,
only one man cares on that team.
While we are on the topic of baseball, so division series, let's start with the one that's over, the Mets.
The fighting grimaces.
The likable Mets.
It's so disgusting, isn't it?
Yeah, it's. Man, I was full on ready to hate them for the way that they treated the Marlins at the end of the last season. And they are a team that, they have the highest payroll in baseball. They shouldn't be an underdog, yet they feel like one.
Well, because they got rid of some players that they had traded for last year, you know.
Verlander and Scherzer.
So Verlander washed, done. My nightmare is over. He's gone. Like, he's just done. Scherzer we love, but the old age has kind of kicked in. Lindor is just too likable. I never hated him.
Nah.
How could you?
He came from Cleveland, so.
Yeah. I have no, my uncle, for marriage, love you, Billy, is a Mets fan, so I'm like, I'm a Texan if they go to the World Series. But Conforto's okay, Alonso's okay, but like, and the thing is that their owner, whose name escapes me right now, because I haven't thought about him all season, you guys will remind me clearly.
I think it's Steve Cohen.
Yes.
Yeah. He took a step back of being a prominent figure in comparison to last year. And I think that's good when certain owners aren't in your goddamn face, one, for it. Especially for baseball. It's so weird. I want personality from players, but I'm too old school. I don't want. And this is coming from having a Steinbrenner as an owner for such a long time. But, like, he was just very not good for the palate. And everything's kind of working. And it's the power of friendship, right? But I like how people call him Scrappy. But this is, the grimace helped it out, man. And that's the thing about baseball, too, is that don't count a team out because they're ass in the first half. Once All-Star season comes, it's a different game.
Yeah. Yeah, this is, yeah, they've been the best record in baseball. Grimace is just walking onto New York subways and just having the time of his life.
And we all like Grimace, too, right?
Yeah, I don't think anybody hates Grimace.
Grimace, we don't care about Ronald, right?
I mean, Ronald, no, it's been a while.
Grimace. So, you gotta go with Grimace, baby.
Yeah, yeah. And nobody cares about Birdie as well. That's
Yeah, I didn't even know who that was.
Yeah, you remember the bird? Yeah, little bird. I think her name is literally Birdie. Really. So, yeah, nobody really cares. It's just, yeah, it's really Grimace. And, man, I can't help but like what's going on with the Mets. So there's that. You've got Game 5 between the Padres and Dodgers, and we have two things running here. We have two things with here. We have possibly the Padres narrative continuing on on one end, and then you've got the other end of the Dodgers being the big bad team. Really, the team that I think a lot of people, man, it'd be fun to see them lose, to see them spend all that money and then have all that happen. But And then
may I intervene?
And then you've got, you know, our narratives with like Dave Roberts being, for me at least, being the Doc Rivers of baseball, and this could also further that narrative, where he just can't get any of this done. So even with all the tools at hand, and I really would like to see Major League Baseball going into slight panic mode a little bit. Where the teams that they wanted to see in the World Series, which probably was the Dodgers, right? They really wanted the Dodgers to go out there. They really wanted Ohtani in the World Series. Just to have that all ruined would be great. Consolation prize would be a New York team in the World Series, which, given the way things are going, they might get both of them again. And that's also a narrative.
That would be fun.
And then, of course, they most want, we know they want Yanks-Dodgers. We know that's the World Series that they want. But it might not happen. However, we got 2-2. We got a Game 5 in LA. And that's been a really fun series. Those teams are throwing haymakers out there. That is currently the best rivalry in baseball right now.
May I intervene?
Go ahead.
One, I think actually a lot of people want to go to the Dodgers because they have such a national appeal. We're like the three people who don't. But you forgot the narrative that I've been like riding on this entire baseball season through two seasons of the show's iteration. It's all about the Shohei show. And it's not that I want him to fail, but because it's his first postseason, I know better than anybody in this chat right now, in this podcast about big-time, paid players during the regular season and then once they get into the postseason. And Shohei has been no way right now. So has Aaron Judge. That's okay. I love how Andrew sent me that thing in the chat. I'm like, I know this. We did like a statistical analysis of this man's like assery before. But I do agree with you. They had the Dodgers, but I think there's a bigger national appeal to them. And I think there's a lot of like non-baseball teams or baseball fans, like who just come in casual, super casual, that want to win because how we can unite. I also think there's a lot of teams who just don't like the Padres because they can't find a player who's identifiable to them to like. And the thing about Shohei was the whole pitching and DHing. And I told you guys 3 years ago, the minute you gave him a Cy Young, an MVP because of his pitching and batting, you have to do it in perpetuity almost. But like, there's no like likable star for people who want to gravitate to for the Padres, right? Because Manny Machado seems arrogant. You guys saw what he was doing.
They do have a lot of great hateable players, right? It's almost like Bad Boys, Pistons type of hateable players.
You have Fernando Tatis, who is like Mr. Ringworm, but he's like dance and everything like that. I'm like, that's a Dominican energy, baby. You know, you got Yu Darvish, who everybody was just kind of like, what's going on there? But when you look at the Dodgers, they're composed of very likable people. Shohei, for all intents and purposes, is likable. Freddie Freeman, super likable.
The Dodgers are as if Hollywood would make a baseball team. It'd probably be the Los Angeles Dodgers. You got your likable white guy, Freddie Freeman. You got Mookie Betts, who's your token black guy. And then you've got an exotic Asian in Shohei Ohtani. And
can I make a wrestling analogy?
And then like, you know, some of these like, you know, colorful Latinos sitting around them. Like this is, Hollywood could construct a baseball team?
I'll give you the wrestling analogy. Here's the wrestling analogy. The Dodgers feel like that 1980s Hulk Hogan. They're red and yellow. Hulkamania, you just like it. Did you do your prayers, take your vitamins, all that stuff? There's something, that's why I think the appeal of people are. And I don't even hate the Dodgers. I had them go against the Cleveland Guardians, and I was pretty much almost wrong about that, right? Or I am wrong about that coming into it, or maybe soon to be wrong about that. But I think they're still like likable to people. I think I'd just rather just get over with and have them win a World Series so we could just push the whole and be done with the Shohei greatest of all time narrative. Either he is or isn't. You get rid of the Dave Roberts narrative, the Doc Rivers that we coined and created. Trademark, copyright, patent, right? It is, though, I'm going to go on this for two more seconds, more interesting already this postseason than it was last year, which we didn't even watch at all. And the fact that you have this as your first round in the NLDS sets the tone. Because the thing is, I like players on both sides. I want players on both sides. You know, if they were on my team.
This postseason is a bit different. I mean, a lot different, I think. I think last year's postseason was full of a lot of kind of fluky type of deals. I mean, the Marlins made the playoffs. Now you know it was a fluky season. The Diamondbacks had like a fluky run as well to the World Series. the Rangers kind of felt a little dirty. They kind of paid their way into a World Series, right?
Yeah, very nasty.
You had the Astros making it far again, ALCS, yeah. Which was the difference this year where they didn't make it out of the wild card round. So there was already like your villain was already gone for this postseason, right? And then you've got last season. I mean, you had like the Phillies.
The Diamondbacks weren't even that interesting, so you can't even like.
Get true, them. Like nobody knew who was on the team.
You had to educate me on Corbin Carroll. Yeah. I think.
Even like the Rangers, I don't. Aside from like Scherzer, how many of the guys could you actually name on that team aside like Scherzer and Corey Seager?
I knew they had.
And Adolis Garcia like made himself a name.
They had that Jake post-season. DeGrom, Jacob DeGrom, who didn't even play.
Yeah, he played for. He probably pitched for like what one game, and then he was out. So, yeah. So it was.
Which is crazy. Like you got riding the pine tar kind of World Series ring, and you're one of the best pitchers in our generation. The 2010s.
So, last season was not great from a postseason standpoint. This season, there was a lot of great narratives. You got the Tigers right now, kind of relifting the spirits of Detroit.
AJ Hinch eliminated the team that got him fired.
Exactly. So there's that. The Royals are young and likable and doing everything that the Orioles and Blue Jays could not, right? Correct. So there's that.
Frauds.
You had the Orioles being frauds, and then you had the Brewers kind of showing that the NL Central is really the default like division in baseball. Bad. Like the NL Central is probably the weakest division in baseball now, mm-hmm. and that's with the AL Central having the White Sox in it. So just a nothing team, but the rest, the Mets. And their run. You had the Braves making the playoffs despite all of their injuries. But, you know, they lost, so I'm happy about that. And
not just that, Francisco. What's great about this postseason so far is past the wild card, you've had three forms of DS that have been in-division rivalries.
Yeah. Yeah, though Cleveland. Yeah, the division series this year was have been great. Yeah, and the only team that screwed it up was Baltimore. But that was happy. That was great for you.
I'm perfectly fine with that for obvious reasons because I was not me writing it.
Yeah, Detroit, Cleveland, which are two likable teams that were in that American League Central there.
Scooball is going to be a fantastic Yankee.
The best rivalry in baseball right now between the Dodgers and the Padres. You got the Mets and Phillies division rivalry there, and that, you know, just the commute alone, both teams. Opposing fans can make it to their road games there. Mm-hmm. And then you had, and even then, Kansas City versus New York has that feeling of Pacers, Knicks, you know, the, you know, Midwest versus big city type of thing, right?
Big team, small team.
David versus and Goliath everybody kinda loves type that. Of thing. Yeah.
And, payroll, right?
Yeah. And then you have like the, even like, yeah, so we got the Tigers in Cleveland, and then let's talk about the other series, Charles. The one that's you like you said, you win either way if things turn out one way or the other. But you got the Royals and Yanks. The Yanks won yesterday by one run, 3-2. Some inner game narratives were continued for you. One, Aaron Judge is still non-existent in the playoffs, and two. Giancarlo Stanton is a real G. Is a real G in the playoffs.
Man. I would kiss that man on his
And face. Even Jazz Chisholm Jr. gave you a bit of a chuckle as well.
But I like Jazz. All right, yeah. May I? I'm going to steal this for 2 seconds.
Yeah. Because I watched right, that so game yesterday.
I did too. So the narrative... All right. To remind the few people who watch, shout out to Freddie and BU. I know you guys don't jump on anymore, but we still love you because you're one of our few locals that come in and doing it for a while. You're our groupies. The narrative was...
We have 60 people watching the show right now, so it's good.
And I love all 60 people. But the narrative for a while for me was I can't lose either way because either we win the World Series and I spend $545 on a goddamn title belt I'm not even gonna curse onto it.
My God,
I'll do it,
dude.
I'll do it.
The
I'll
amount of we'll talk about how much I've spent in Stanley Cup Championship merch.
You know what happens is no. I'm gonna sidestep that real quickly. The older you get, the more you realize your time is on this earth is gonna be gone. The more memorabilia you want to buy when your team has success.
Yeah, the Marlins won the World Series in 2003, and I wish I had more of stuff from when that happened. And now I mean, you saw me the last 4 years with this account. Yeah, I've been
the worst person telling you what to buy.
With the Marlins stuff, just collecting old stuff from back then and just like trying to relive my childhood in that sense. But now with the Panthers and this cup run, I haven't gone completely insane like other people, but I've spent a good amount of cash.
I'm saying that I would and I will. I have no shame because all I could afford in 2009 was a hat. When the Heat won those years, I bought a hat. You know, like this time we're doubling down because I'm 35, man. I don't know when this stuff is guaranteed, and I don't think it's gonna be an easy trip to get to the World Series. Because see, things you can get to the World Series, but you have to win it. The point is that I will spend so much money. But so the narratives have been either we win it all or we lose and Aaron Boone is fired. The only way I lose is if he's still my manager, you know, the next season. I will cry. I think we've done trades. I've been invested. I was ho-hum last year. I was a little bitch about it. I'll be the first one to tell you for. But there's a lot of moving pieces. I like Garrett Cole came back. And mind you, I predict Garrett Cole Cy Young with. Go look at our episodes. I actually did it. I was down to the T. I hit the over. But Judge was hitting all this stuff. And I had a lot riding on this because he's the one that just needs to figure it out, I feel. Because this offense is really reliant on him and Soto. And Soto's been kind of like okay in the series. Jazz is perfect defensively. I love him. I love his energy. I'm very happy that we have him. Thank you, Marlins, for always giving us your best players. But then we get to Big Baby G. Giancarlo. Formerly known as, you know, what, Michelson or whatever the hell he was over in Miami. Oh, he a real Michael. Well, you know what?
Mike
wasn't that the name
Stanton.
Of an angel? Mike Stanton? Wasn't the name of an angel or disciple? Because yeah. You know what? He's the prophet of good tidings here. He's my kingdom of heaven. Because right now, Judge is just stinking it up. Andy Rizzo is hurt. I think that really affected our offense more than you think. And I love Rizzo, actually. I think he's good. I think he's not coming back. Because I believe we have a club option on him. But yesterday's game was what I talked about between being what I've been saying for 2 years, 3 years, really, about being a big-time player and the big-time player. And there's a reason why that THE actually matters. Because you can step aside or you can step up. And it's the same guys you played on. This is not the National League. You're going against the same pitchers that you've seen at some structure, at some point in the season. And the man's like 2 for 30. I'm just being egregious with numbers, but they're particularly low. But then Stanton hits a homer. He hits an RBI double, I think. And then he hits a homer. And you're just like, God bless you. Because what have I always said about Stanton? I don't, like regular season, he's going to hit that 25-30. I'm always accurate. But I always said, I need him healthy during postseason because Judge cannot get there. And I'm like the petty train. Where I'm like, the narrative continues, but this has the all or nothing feel about it because this is like the perfect combo. You have Garrett Cole pitching lights out, and I love him, but his window will eventually leave. Rodon is Rodon, man. It's Jekyll and Hyde. I don't hate him.
It's a roller coaster.
I don't love him. I'm happy to have him. Stroman, thank God we have him on 2-year contract. He is the weekly.
Isn't he off the postseason roster?
Yeah, he's off this roster.
At least, for this series. And then
if we get the CS, he's going to be middleman. But like he's just too inconsistent. But that's been his career. So I know what we were getting. The idea is that Stroman contributes to the wins needed to beat out the Orioles. That's how I viewed it, right? Because we only beat him out by 4 games in the AL East. Lucas Gill was a nice surprise. And then Clark Schmidt came back from injury. He's good. So it is as good as a perfect storm because we've always been bad about getting stud pitchers, in my opinion. Aside from the year we had CC and AJ Burnett and Pettit came back, and now I feel about him. But this is the all or nothing. And here's the thing I tell people. Stanton's been a Yankee as long as Judge has been. And he's really co-captain, truthfully speaking. You can have captain.
The only reason he's the captain is because he
that contract.
He sweetened the pot to get him.
You are absolutely right. But, you know, like, there's, to me, there's two captains on that team, two legitimate captains. People are going to hit me at this. I don't really care. It's my opinion. You can have your opinion. This, we're adults. It is Giancarlo, and it's Gerrit Cole. Plain and simple. Hishigoga's gone. He's doing great in San Diego. You're welcome, everybody. Higashioka. But those are two leaders that you kind of go on. Because Cole is most definitely a leader, hands down. I will. Like, we win the World Series. I'm also buying his jersey. It is due time. Like, tonight might be the elimination game. I'm going to rip my shirt off. But I have so much vested into this. And that's what makes this postseason great. Because I want to see the team, if we don't do it, I want to see the team that topples us go all the way. And currently we're going against the Royals, right? And who did I support in 2015 as finding the postseason team? Because my team can make it. The Royals. There's a beautiful story that is connected here. I also want my team to win the World Series because I want to feel what Francisco and Andrew have felt, because I have been lonely. Lonely with my team's winning stuff. You got the Panthers winning the Stanley Cup. Mm. You got the Lightning, who had like a two-peat, almost a three-peat. The Rays went to the World Series at some juncture. The last
closest team I've had has been the Heat.
The Heat was the last thing, and that was 12 years ago.
Yeah.
I need a reason why the Peppas, guys.
Yeah.
Because wrestling can only go so far. That's my rant. That's all I'm going to say on baseball. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I've watched almost all the games. Not until full completion, but I thoroughly watched it. I also hate watched a few things on the Dodgers yesterday. It was great. But thank you for your time.
Mm. Oh, yeah. Yeah, great postseason so far. I think baseball is really happy with it, but they do want one matchup, and I know we all know what they want. So we'll see. We'll see how it goes. Let's see. Any more thoughts outside from that? If not, then we'll...
Well, I would like to just, since we're on the topic of baseball, I'd like to mention something real quick. The new uniform experiment.
Oh, that's over. Yeah, that's over.
The sweaty nipple showing because of all
the balls being shown.
Yeah, starting next season, that's done.
All-star jerseys are no longer going to be a thing anymore, which is great. Or at least they will be, at least they'll have the players wear like their own uniforms, or at least an all-starified version of their own uniforms, which I think is the way they're going to go with it, which is still better than having just them wearing plain old National League versus American League stuff. Because nobody really likes that. Everybody just likes seeing their players with their own uniforms. The Pro Bowl used to do it. NBA used to do it as well. I think it'd be too insane. NHL's never done it. So I think it might be too insane to have all those colors happening at once with those players. But it's fun. It's fun to see it in baseball because it's the one sport where that would actually make a lot of sense. Because you don't really have a lot of fast movement.
Yeah, that's the only sport that you could really do it in.
Okay.
It's just prettier, to be honest.
Yeah, and so we'll get the good uniforms. Sorry to everybody who bought uniforms this year, jerseys with like the tiny letters and all that stuff. So that's gone. And I think next year we can finally start buying regular jerseys again. Oh, speaking of, I guess it is 43 minutes in. NHL season has started. So we are back in hockey mode for everybody, especially me. Been going good, been doing great, selling shirts and the like. Over the offseason, Stanley Cup champion Florida Panthers went to game one of this season. Panthers raised the banner. We beat down Boston. It was great, and I bought a jersey, guys. I bought. They ran out of.
To buy that damn title belt.
They ran out of Barkovs, so I had to go with the next best thing, which was Matthew Tkachuk. So I got a Tkachuk jersey in white. I didn't have a white version of the Panthers' current set of uniforms.
Soto just brought Torres home. I'm feeling erect. I'm sorry.
I hear Andrew.
You guys are going to get live.
Yeah, yeah. So it was, I've spent a lot of money this offseason on Stanley Cup gear. I've got the Stanley Cup with the water from, or the ice from the final. That's at my desk at work. I've got a license plate frame on my car. I've got a decal on my car as well for the Stanley Cup. I've got an actual Stanley, really replica Stanley Cup in my room, hanging above me right now. I got that jersey. I bought Stanley Cup patches and ironed them on to every single jersey that I own. I also, let's see, what else did I do? I went to this game. I went to two games in the final. What else? And I'm not done yet. I'm not done because I got to buy a patch that has Stanley Cup champions and put it on that jersey because it didn't come with one yet. So I think I have one more patch. So I might just iron that one onto that jersey, the Kachuk jersey. I spent a clean $300 on that one, and the rings came out. So once they have those replicas for sale, I will get one of those too.
Will tell you right now, you're going bigger than I would actually go. I don't know if Andrew would do the same thing, but I feel like a title belt and a shirt, or a hat. This man's bringing out replica rings.
Yeah, I kind of want a little of everything right now. I want a little bit of everything.
I will say this. I am strongly considering getting, and that was actually something I wanted to ask you guys. Strongly considering getting, I was thinking of getting, albeit very cheap, but replica rings and like miniature Stanley Cups with the year inscribed on it.
Yeah, I mean, get what you want, get what you can.
Y'all are grown-ass men. You know what I've bought.
Yeah, exactly.
Wait till you hear later what I bought.
How many Funko Pops Charles has? So, you know.
Ex-girlfriends. But, I mean, like, I do have two world championship titles in my office. So yeah. Not my bar license, not my certificates, not my law degree. Titles.
Yeah,
so
I don't have that in my office either. I don't have any of my degrees in my office right now. I have a dinosaur, but I don't have anything else there. Yeah.
As long as you don't have the U.S. Constitution and the American flag, because for anybody who's out there, that is a stereotype lawyer thing.
I've got the little mini flag, but I've got one for Nicaragua and Minnesota as well. So it's just kind of like a
row. Something at you.
I have the the little tiny ones. The ones that you get when you get your citizenship. Yeah, that's what
I'm not going to question what's important to you.
Yeah, so I have that, I have a Venezuela, and I have a Nicaragua. And they all match. So, you know, and they're like sitting next to a tree that I have there. And but it was a great atmosphere, I'll tell you that much, man. The Panthers have sold out season tickets for the first time in their history. And
well, guys, you got to see the cup.
Yeah, and you know, I never got to take a picture
on the Twitter. So
I never got to take a picture with it because every time they were kind of prancing it around at like an event, it was just like in the middle of the day or whatever. I'm just like, I can't make it down to Broward, and I have a career, so I just never got a chance to. But whatever, man. Now that they're on the cup, I can, whenever they do have it, pass around or anything like that. You know, or if I go to the Hockey Hall of Fame in Toronto, it'll be there anyways. So either way, I'll find it. I'll take a photo with it at some point. But, it's been a great off season. I'm very happy for the club. And
Who got re-signed for 8 years? Not Verhaeghe.
Verhaeghe got extended for 8 years.
He got extended. Yeah. Okay, he did get extended.
Yeah, he got extended for 8 years. The team has pretty much extended most of their core now. It's just light years compared to what they did, you know, a decade ago now, and especially in comparison to like the Marlins or whatever. I'm just very happy, and you know, they had like nice tribute to Johnny Gaudreau. I think every team has done that so far. Moment of silence for him. And
don't drink and drive, guys. Just
over. Yeah. And then Utah's new team played their first game.
So I had to ask about that. And Andrew educated me a little bit onto it. And the reason why is because I knew it was coming, but it's so rare for me because I thought the franchise is folded. As far as I'm concerned, using the same players,
yeah,
it is a fold.
They're doing a Charlotte Hornets type of weird deal where the Utah team is a brand new franchise that the Utah Jazz owners bought and paid for. Right, they paid an expansion fee, But the players are all, and coaching staff and whatever, are all from Arizona. And the Arizona team, which what, like their rights and everything like that, were being held by the owner of that team, but he, I guess, couldn't get the a deal secured in Arizona for a new arena, or at least for the land for a new arena, because he was going to use the Coyotes' identity and all that stuff to make a reanimated version of the Coyotes, and now sold all of the rights back to the NHL. So now the NHL owns the Coyotes' rights. If somebody wants to put a team in Arizona and actually has an arena for it, they can buy it up and make the franchise. So it's just a team in suspension, but who knows? I think the NHL wants to expand. I personally don't think they should, but yeah, they want to. And they're probably going to expand by four more cities. And Arizona might be one. Atlanta is trying to get a team back now, and there might be interest in Houston, and they probably will probably, I don't know, there's probably like a third city or a fourth city there that we're not sure of right now. And maybe one more in Canada, probably Quebec. Aside from that, I think that would probably be it for the NHL as far as expansion is going. But yeah, that's the situation with Utah. They play in where the Jazz play. And that arena is going to get heavily renovated because it is basketball only right now. All the seats are all messed up. They have obstructed views on both ends. And they basically have to gut it and then redo all the seating. It'll probably be similar to what Seattle did because that's where the Supersonics played. And they did the same thing, was basketball only. And then they gutted it and made it fit hockey. So that's probably what they're going to do, but it'll take years. For right now, they'll probably play there until and just kind of do renovations and stuff, I guess, in piecemeal from here on out. Aside from that, any other hockey stories that I'm missing, Andrew? Stamkos is playing his first game in Nashville.
Don't right remind now. Me.
So,
don't kill the man. Yeah.
I mean, it's a big thing. So there's new faces and new places. Ovechkin is trying to go for Gretzky's record. He had a pretty so-so, not great season last year. And maybe he seems like the guy that would not retire. I think he's going to keep playing until he gets that record. Aside from that, I don't have any other stories that's popping up for now. So we had Seattle, we had all those other teams. And I think
Charles will continue his NHL 24 playing to learn more about hockey. I think I've evolved a little bit. You know, we're in there. I will go to at least maybe 2-3 Panthers games a season. So I promise I will be more vigilant.
We're learning. I think as far as teams are concerned,
it's too early, like, man.
But there's still some narratives and things that are being pushed going forward in this season. There's some teams that are knocking on the door, especially like the Dallas Stars and the New York Rangers or the Carolina Hurricanes, that have just kind of not gotten it done. Panthers repeating, that'll be hard. Be really hard. They've had...
There's the king of repeating. Andrew, tell us what it takes to repeat.
I don't want to say luck because... You know, that would downplay that a team has to play well. Some of it has to do with luck because the playoffs can be a real crapshoot, let's be honest. But, you know, the big thing is having... I'm trying to think. You have to have good players. You need Bob needs to do his thing again. A team does not, even if they don't win, the way I see it, for the most part, the Conn Smythe is the award for the best player that is not a goaltender. Because I don't care how good your top guy is, if you don't have a goalie who is on it, you're not going to go anywhere. And, you know, Bob finally made his ludicrous contract worth it. And I say that as a fan of a team paying our goalie $9 million a year, which is also a ludicrous contract. But the second that you win that cup, every single penny is worth it. Bob needs to be on his thing again. You'll need your depth players again. You know, the Panthers are just a very well-rounded team last year, and they still almost blew it. Yeah, it'll be tough. And it ultimately, I think it'll just come down to, you know, forget the regular season. You know, there's a curse about getting the President's Trophy. Just don't even bother. Basically, try to replicate what you did last year. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. I will be honest. And I'm not someone who's going to say, oh, we should have won the cup in 2022 when we lost in six to Colorado. But something that really hurt us was not having Braden Point due to injury. That hurt supremely. Because he's our bumper on the power play or really anything. He's that guy in the middle. Like if you draw an X of where the players are on the ice, he's the center of that X. But he's also a sniper to be sure. And he's just getting better. So the fact that we lost him, for the cup final really hurt. Yeah, it's make sure the guys aren't injured. I don't know. It's a bit of a crapshoot, like I said. It's a lot of things have to go your way. The good news, though, is most of your roster is intact. That's a huge thing, especially these days with the salary cap. That's what's killed us in these past few years, because we had to get rid of Verhaeghe. I really wish we could have stayed. We had to get rid of Yanni Gourde. Basically, at this point, your Stanley Cup window is going to last maybe 5 years at most, due to the salary cap. The good news is you guys are pretty young still. When we got to the Cup, our core players like Stamkos and they were all in their 30s by that point. Kucherov was kind of in his mid to late 20s. Vasilevsky, mid to late 20s. So we were an older-ish core. You guys are still pretty young. You have Tkachuk is young. Verhaeghe is very young. Bob is the only one that's getting up there in age, really. He's like, what, 34, 35?
Mm-hmm. Sergei Bobrovsky.
And again, when I say older, this is all relative to sports.
Well, they're doing at a young
Bob
age.
Is 36 yeah. right now.
Yeah.
Oh, he's even older than I thought.
Mm-hmm. And he's been doing this for...
He's been doing this seasons. Since... Yeah, so...
There's some tread on them tires, brother.
Yeah, he is definitely up there.
So, I mean, right now, we've got Spencer Knight. He's been called up now. We sent Chris Drieger down to the AHL. So the free agent backup that we're replacing Anthony Stolarz with has been sent down to the AHL because we're getting Spencer Knight up now. So I think the Panthers are going to ease Knight into being a 1B type of scenario to eventually take over Sergei Bobrovsky's role, because Bob signed a 10-year contract. with the Panthers. We're on year 6 of it now. So halfway through, win a Stanley Cup. Not bad. Not bad at all on this big old contract.
Yeah, and I'm gonna be honest, man. If you don't win that cup at all under that huge contract, that's huge. I mean, I won't say it would be as bad as the DiPietro contract, but oh boy, that would have been brutal.
So Sergei Bobrovsky is on. Actually, hold on. What was his length of his contract? Actually, it was a 7-year deal. Sorry about that. So this is year 6 of 7. So this is the last 2 seasons, actually, counting this.
Okay,
one.
So
you know, the idea is to get him into, to get Spencer Knight into that role as the new goaltender, a la, let's say, Tim Thomas did with Tuukka Rask.
Yeah.
So that's the hope there. I think this is year one of this. I think we brought up Spencer Knight a lot earlier than expected because he seemed like a phenom, and then he had to go through assistance program and bounce back pretty nicely in the AHL. Was on the Panthers postseason roster throughout the final, as well as like a third backup goaltender. But doesn't have his name on the cup. I guess they gave him a ring at the very least, because I think he did get in a few games last season anyways, and was part of all of this starting in like 2021. So, the situation, it's hard. There's been very few teams to repeat. I was looking at a post by, I think it was Bar Down or one of those, maybe TSN, showing the Stanley Cup winners over the last it's like 40 years now, right? Or actually 50 years, last 50 years. And starting in, let's say, around the time of expansion, of the 93 expansion, there's been very few repeat back-to-back winners out there. It's been very rare.
Which makes me extra proud of the fact that we were able to accomplish it. And
Tampa,
listen,
Pittsburgh, then
Detroit,
the Red Wings, and aside from that, it hasn't really been done much. Aside from that, the Kings won not back to back, but 2 in 3 years. The Blackhawks won 3 in 6, right? And then you've had some sparing ones between like the Avs in the late 90s, 2000s.
No es fácil.
And yeah, aside from that, it's been a lot of one-time winners out there. The parity in the league's been really great.
That's part of what I mean by it's a crapshoot, because I think someone did the math, did the math or whatever, and I believe they found that the NHL has the most parity of any of the pro sports championships.
Yeah.
And again, it just comes down to, one bad, like, look at Tkachuk last year, or 2023, I mean. That dude, he was not playing 100% in the final. Absolutely not. He, broke his sternum?
I don't know if you have Amazon Prime, but if you do, they have the NHL Face-Off series on there. I watched all 6 episodes. It is incredibly well done. They follow several players. I think it was Philip Forsberg in Nashville, Jacob Trouba in New York, Quinn Hughes in Vancouver. Who else? Gabriel Landeskog in Colorado. Connor McDavid with Edmonton. Matthew Tkachuk with the Panthers. And I think I'm missing somebody. Jeremy Swayman with the Bruins, David Pastrnak, and William Nylander with the Leafs. So a nice, good chunk of players from all parts of the league in all sorts of different situations in their careers. Getting their behind the scenes, seeing them throughout the season. And all these guys were playing for teams that had these postseason narratives from last year. And it was so well done how they pieced all of their stories in a way together, given how it happened during the playoffs. And the series ends with two episodes covering the Oilers and the Panthers Stanley Cup final. I saw the Panthers final Stanley Cup final video that ESPN made for ESPN Plus. That is the official championship video for this year, and which I'm sad about, because I mean, they used to be physical mediums that you could buy, like the Marlins ones with me right now, but I wish they would have sold like a Blu-ray or something like that at the very least. But even then, the ESPN one, I felt was like made as an afterthought. Like they had to make one because they have a contract with the NHL. But I think they made it just to make it. It seemed like something that I feel like there are people that could have done that on YouTube.
Are you saying it's arbitrary?
Yeah, an arbitrary thing that they made, the quality. Yeah, they had some interviews and some things like that, but the quality I felt wasn't as good as the Amazon series. That was really well done. And
I don't disagree with you on that.
The Amazon series was like so well done. I wish Amazon had the contract to make the Stanley Cup final video, because I think they had the cameras that were in there in the locker rooms and all that stuff. They had interviews during the finals and what the players were thinking. It felt like those 90s, 2000s championship videos that came out for every team that won a championship back in the day and for any sport. And but I do recommend watching that Amazon series. And I feel like, yeah, that was way better than the ESPN one made. So.
Well, ESPN's so shallow, you know, and they're hollow is the other word I'll use to rhyme with a lot of their stuff. That's the reason why the show that we're doing right now kind of came into existence, and it's not surprising that, you know, they can't even reflect a sport that's not something that can be highly emphasized on their own program.
Yeah. All right, so we are 1 hour and 8 minutes in, so we haven't done a word for non-sponsors, so that's people and places and things and concepts we've been doing. Using and enjoying over the last week. So I don't know who wants to go first this week. Yanks are up 1-0, by the way.
Yay.
I don't hear Andrew, but okay.
I'll go ahead.
All right.
Well, I have to, my nostalgia is tingling, cause this morning, the original Backyard Baseball was re-released on Steam.
That's true.
And I went ahead and got it. I'm playing it right now, or I was playing it a little bit ago. It feels the same. It's an odd feeling. You know, I had found it on an emulator. A while ago, it wasn't playing well. This one is a lot more smooth than having to do it on an emulator. And, you know, I really can't wait for 2001 to release, if they can even do it, because of the MLBPA licensing rights. And I think all of those players are retired by this point. That one, it felt a bit more polished than the 07 version. Oh, sorry, I'm watching the Tigers Guardians game. But still, it's fun to be playing a game like this again. You know, little bits of childhood, you know, every little bit that you can bring back. It's nice, you know, it breaks apart the life of an adult every little bit, and that's nice. By the way, pop quiz, who is the best player in backyard baseball?
This is not Pablo.
It is Pablo, of course. And he will be my promo code, Pablo Sanchez, because he's the GOAT. He's good in everything he plays.
See, that's the thing. Like, I forget how old I am in comparison to you sometimes, where I barely play backyard baseball, but I know of it.
I didn't play much of the 97 version. I was only 5 when it released.
Yeah, I've got it playing in the background here, or at least the Steam page for it. It's cheap. It's $9 right now.
So I, like I said, I played more of the 01 version. But sorry, I keep yawning. But it's nice that there's a company that's bringing it all back, and looking forward to more of them coming out shortly.
All right. Let's see.
I can go next because mine's not as... I will not be doing any of the non-sponsors about Hotlanta. That's going to have its own segment. Yeah. So I'm going to go for the one that came in clutch when I had to be 10 hours driving back, because I drove. And I don't mind driving. I need to save money as it is. So that's the reason why I kind of like did it. But I was starving. And when I'm on a road trip, I'm not the guy who stops and gets food and everything like that. I just go, man. And in Georgia, what delayed is coming out of Atlanta, they took a triple lane into a single lane, so that delayed me for an hour. So I was on the road for like 10 hours. Of course, I take a stop to go pee and get gas. I'm not, you know, a troglodyte, but still, right, you know, things happen. So my non-sponsor is Taco Bell, because immediately what I got, the minute I got out, and I broke my little rule about, like, not fast food for once a week. I got twice. I'm sorry. But damn, it was good. Because I had a cantina burrito.
Should we make an amendment to the rule for, like, special occasions type of thing?
Yeah.
Like birthdays or, you know, vacations or whatever.
That's fine. Your boy weighed in at 161.8 today, and it's, I think, muscle more than anything else, so that's fine. But yeah, like, we can make the exception. But I was on a road trip coming back, and I'm not going to go to – I want to sit in my own home, you guys, coming back from a 10-hour drive. I don't want to, like, sit down at, you know, Chili's or something Sunday night. I want to unpack my stuff, so I ordered their Lux box that they have, or the Cantina box, and I had their Cantina chicken burrito. It's delicious. They've given you some additional quality. It's still reasonably priced. It is not going to be the price of 2008. I'm so sorry. But that's the way it is. And thankfully, I'm in a position where I can try it and go from there. And it's still delicious as ever. I don't even have to be a fatty and go elsewhere. And it's Taco Bell. I don't have to say more. I'm just saying what I would tell you, Francisco, because I don't think you've done it yet. And Andrew, I know you've been good on your fast food. Just try the Cantina stuff, because they just season it better. And doesn't taste like the slime, but it's delicious slime. I'm sorry. Crack is good to some people. Angel Dust is good to others. For me, it's Taco Bell when I want it. And I switch between that and Wendy's. Those are really the only two fast foods I eat. And it's just really good. So promo code, you know, Taco Bell, y'all know what it's about. 6 years you've heard me on this stuff and it's still good. Promo code Cantina.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm wavering, Charles, because I still haven't burned mine for this month yet. Either to do Taco Bell, or do I do the Krabby Patty?
I gotta try the Krabby Patty in November. I can already tell you that now.
Like, I feel like as an obligation to have the Krabby Patty.
We use SpongeBob a lot in our gifts in the chat, and Squidward. Yeah. No, Patrick. Sorry.
Yeah,
Patrick's
SpongeBob is universal. I'm the first one to tell you that. Yeah, SpongeBob is universal. I freaking adored the show, And I think I might just have to do that instead. But if I do it, I'll do it up. I'll get some large fries, and I'll do it up if I'm going to do it, right? Because it'll be a very, very special occasion in special. That sense. Yeah.
You got to treat it the way you would treat a Zelda.
Exactly. Race. Yeah, and yeah, essentially, yeah, it'll be a dinner. It won't be lunch where I'm just trying to get just some minutes to myself during, you know, work hours. Like, it'll be a legitimate experience for me, for myself to enjoy my own company, right? Okay. All right, so my non-sponsor is American Dad.
Oh, good show. Just already. Just please. It's better than Family Guy. Go ahead.
It is. And I finished off some other shows, and I've just kind of been in a bit of a rut a little bit as far as like watching TV shows is concerned. I've been consuming a lot of Godzilla lore. So that's kind of been my thing.
Did you watch Minus One yet?
I have not watched Minus One yet. I don't know where it's distributed right now, Charles.
It's on Netflix. It's on Netflix? It's 2023. It's on Netflix.
All right, because I know Netflix has a bunch of stuff. They had the Godzilla anime, they had Godzilla Singular Point, which I watched. And of course, the Warner Brothers legendary Godzilla
Con was good too.
Yeah. But Godzilla. I haven't watched Minus One, and I should, so I'll get on that. But I've been waiting. I'm just trying to get a TV show to consume, and so I was just kind of like flipping around. I checked Max. I'm like, okay, I finished Kite Man and all these other things.
I wish I could love Kite Man.
It was fine. You know, it was fine in the sense of it's a side show within the universe of the Harley Quinn show.
He's the best character on the Harley Quinn show. But like, I just couldn't get past episode one
as a main character. It's fine. It's okay. It's more of a dumb type of thing that you listen to and you watch. Just it doesn't Hell really yeah. flesh out the lore or whatever that universe of the Harley Quinn universe. But once again, it's that entire universe is also kind of stupid. So it's really comedic at the same time. However, American Dad, I just saw it on my recommendations. I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot that this show is still continuing on. And so I watched some episodes from season 18 because I just hadn't watched the show in quite a bit. And I watched this one episode where they had to, prove to DCF that Steve wasn't in a troubled household. And I was laughing my ass off one.
Can we talk about Steve for a second?
Yeah, go ahead.
How is it that their jingles, whenever he has a singing episode, are just bangers?
Yeah, every single...
Just bangers.
Every single musical episode that they do is they. I think they do one like once every season now.
Yeah.
Because they know how good they really are.
Their voice actor, and whose name is... He was on Ted. Ted is the sixth of the show, but the main character, or like the main dad or whatever, is Steve. And it's just a banger. He has a fantastic singing voice.
Yeah. But every character on the show is just hilarious. I think they've got these fleshed out personalities that are much better than what you've got on Family Guy.
Who is your favorite character?
Oh man. I mean, Roger's great. Roger's fantastic. I thoroughly enjoy Roger. Klaus has been more fleshed out in the last few seasons.
Can I tell you the one every time he's in, I know I'm in for a good episode.
Principal Lewis.
Principal Lewis. We just do.
Yeah.
Oh, Jinx, yell me a coach. Just everything Lewis based, I'm like, all right, I'm in for a good time.
Yep. He's a good one. He's a fantastic character. Their side characters are really good. Really good.
The Christmas episodes are great. The fact that Santa hates
continued narrative for like the last 15 years.
10 years.
Yeah.
It has one of the best episodes too, Christmas wise, where it's like the Jesus rapture arc.
Yeah.
That came in just it's the tits.
Yeah.
Sorry.
The show is still going strong. I think the fact that Seth MacFarlane's not involved with it aside from voicing Stan and Roger. Like, he's kind of left their writers to their own devices. And I think it's helped a lot more compared to Family Guy, which is, like, on Fox still and has to kind of continue, I guess, their thing that, man, I just feel like Family Guy's more brain rot than anything else. And I like this brain rot term, by the way. It's been It's been really good. I've started to realize how much of the internet has become that. But Family Guy, I feel like, is the show for people who love brain rot, whereas American Dad is for more cerebral.
I think the first 8 seasons of Family Guy had
merit.
Points of merit, yeah. And then sometimes they'll still make me laugh, but there's a difference between a show that makes you want to watch it versus like, okay, it's a YouTube clip scene.
Yeah.
Because I can watch, or Twitter clip scene. I can do it for any Family Guy season. If you tell me it's a funny thing and I laugh, that's fine. But yeah. I'm going to steal this too because I love American Dad, so I'm going to go from there. Stelios episodes.
Stelios Cantos.
The theme song, like, it is the superior version of it.
I like the Ricky Spanish episode.
Ricky Spanish is just a diabolical man. Mm-hmm. And he's everything I wish to be.
So, yeah, American Dad. Promo code Morning Mimosa.
And the show, we're giving his flowers a little bit. It is so different. And this show has been around, guys, for like 20 years. So it is different now than it was then. And it's just different layers of funniness. Originally, it was just that satire of being like a Republican household to now it just said, hey, we're going to get weird with it. And I'm like, I am there for that weirdness.
Like, Stan has become way more of a, you realize he's just like a weird nerdy character as well.
Oh yeah.
He doesn't consider what he does being nerdy, but that's a lot of people who are like conservatives. They didn't realize that they've got these antics and things that they like, you know what I mean? So
the only weird aspect of it is Haley. Like, she's the only, like, the Jeff episodes, like, remember he disappears and he's gone for a bit or whatever. And his story is great with Forrest Whitaker.
Yeah.
Sinbad.
Yeah, Sinbad.
But, like, they're good. But, like, I love a good Francine episode.
Yeah.
Roger, I just know we're good on.
Yeah, Francine's a wild card now, which is great.
Yeah.
You really don't know what she's going to get into. So the whole show is fantastic. So that's it. An hour and 22 now. Andrew, is there any like college football happenings that you want to mention for a bit here?
Oh boy, yes. I will try to speed run through it because a lot has happened.
We have been watching college football as a team.
Especially given what's been happening.
I've been watching like other divisions too. So yeah.
Well, Vanderbilt. We got to talk about that.
Vanderbilt, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Vandy. That was a huge upset. That was their first time beating an AP top number one team. First time they'd beaten Alabama since 1984, I believe. Just huge. You love to see it. I know that Saban isn't there, but Alabama is still kind of the boogeyman. You know, if you can beat them, that's a heck of an achievement. And that's one of those you love to see it moments. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the fans ripped down one of the goalposts, took it 3 miles to the river, dumped it in the river. It was fished out. Yep. The European mind can't even comprehend. Also have to give a huge shout out to Cal Golden Bears. Their fans did a heck of a job at game day. First time that the show had ever visited Berkeley. And by the way, ACC, you don't have to be so obvious that you want Miami to make it to the playoff. Come on now. Really? Dude.
Listen, I will tell. I'll be the first person to tell you. Now, I did not watch last week's game because I was indisposed for Bad Blood. But I watched the weeks prior, where the Hail Mary was like picked off and stuff like that, but not picked off kind of thing. But it's okay because for years the college football has been like rigging everything SEC. So the way you have to look at it, Andrew, is that this is a good balance to help out anybody in the Big 10 or Big 12. Because if you spread up a little bit on the cheating, and the favoritism, then we all win. Because if not, if they had it their way, 10 out of the 12 representatives would be SEC. So you need to accept it. Just beat your team. Beat Colorado. How about that? And then you'll be okay. You know, but now be nice.
I don't deny that. Our team sucks right now. People are calling for Gus Malzahn's job, and
how do you feel about that? You liked Gus when you first hired him, but like, let's pivot here.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know what the issue is. Is the issue with Gus? Is the issue with the players? I don't know. Is the issue with our defensive core? Because everything is going bad right now. Our quarterback sucks. KJ Jefferson. He can't throw worth a damn. The dude overthrew a 2 yard bubble. Overthrew a 2 yard bubble screen. It's not all on him either, because our offensive line collapses very easily. The only aspect of the team that seems to be any good is second half defense. And even then, they can be hit and miss because they can't tackle. They take bad angles to tackle, and when they do get their hands on the guy, they can't seem to wrap up. It's like other teams, they're playing on freshmen when it comes to breaking tackles against us. It's just you can't pinpoint one problem. You know, if you could pinpoint bad play calling, then you could say the issues with Gus or Ted Roof, who's our defensive coordinator, or gosh, I forget his name, but our offensive coordinator used to play for us. That's going to kill me that I can't remember his name.
In the greater college community, Andrew, because there's always like a controversy or just something that's, you know, you're on the RCFB, follow, I guess, RCFB, right, Charles? Because Andrew's one of the boys there, and of course has obviously been credentialed and everything like that.
The best boy.
Yeah, what's the, you know, the overarching controversy? There's always something every week that pops out, everybody's like up in arms over something.
Well, obviously what's going on with Miami, I think everyone but Miami fans thinks that things are rigged in their favor.
Why is it always my teams? Like, this is, can I interject? Like, why? It's Miami now. We just got special nowhere. The Yankees, the Heat to some degree. Y'all a bunch of haters.
Except
but
Titans.
You know what?
Only the Titans.
And the Titans. Except for the Titans because they're ass now. Five. But, a while back, they were a little bit rigged. People hate the Titans now, and I'm like, I'm sorry, we're better than Jacksonville. The 1-3. I know it's like gold covered and, you know, shit covered in gold, six, but still. But I'm sorry. Okay. May I? Would you rather have Clemson? Would you rather have Clemson? I'm sorry that we didn't have 6,000, like, quarterbacks out there. When you had to suffer Jacoby Harris and all these other guys, Tyler Van Dyke, you get Cam Ward, you got some calls. I get that. No sport is perfect, but it's because it's an ACC team that gets the exception. When all that stuff's been going on in the SEC in their games and even their selection process, it's been 20 years. We're not impotent, but we're barely potent, right, as like relevancy. We're not the ones who go sign Steven DeBurse, who went like second in the worst college football final I've ever seen in my life. But we want to hate the U.
I don't want to hate the U, although I kind of do because.
No, that's fine because we're holding the torchbearers of like the Florida team, and we all live in Florida. I get that.
Well,
we here's the Billy thing, Napier for you. where it might be FSU, even though that's probably a trap game. Like, I can understand your hate, but, like, we understand the rationale of Miami-ism, and I get that. But legitimately speaking, there has been no preferential treatment to this, and this is not a good team. I have them losing three games this season, and you know how
they could have lost three games by now.
I actually think FSU will beat us. It's a trap game. I smell it. I see it. I know it. But like to say that it's the ACC, who if you're gonna say it's the riggedness, the riggeting, whatever the term is, why would it be us? Why would it be Clemson? Dabo has the second highest or the most paid contract. It's a legacy technical school now from the last 5-10 years. Mario Cristobal did nothing in Oregon. He's done nothing in Miami. Our best success was with Mark Richt. Why is it Miami? Our quarterback's not even going to win the Heisman. It's going to go to Shador or it's going to go to Milrose because that's how it plays out. We have one good receiver in Xavier Restrepo, but that's because he just kind of catches good. We have no running game. I'm not saying this to you, Andrew, but I follow the Twitter as well. I don't respond to people because I really don't need the troglodytes to respond to, right? But I just want to know why, if we're the ones rigged, how is it not going to be Clemson? Clemson's the better base of it. They're the ones who need it to be rigged, not us. Yeah. I've been holding that in for 5 weeks. Because who would the ACC really want to win? The irrelevant school for the last 20 years that only had for 1 week a number one ranking with a coach that wasn't good enough to win it in Georgia, with quarterbacks who never got drafted, where our best players have been defensive players, including your Jalen Phillips. I'm sorry that he tore his knee at the Titans game. It happened. Or would it be the team that went to like 3 or 4 college football finals, produced Deshaun Watson, DeAndre Hopkins, Trevor Lawrence, won like 2 of the 4 or maybe 1 of the 3, depending how you choke it up. I can't subscribe to it. Is there bad officiating? Sure. There's bad officiating across the board. But we all know that when it comes to like college football rigged, it's going to be SEC first, maybe a little Ohio State, Notre Dame, because that stuff's stupid. Don't get me started on that. USC's trash, so that's great. It's a good feeling. But have all the ACC components, it's always going to be Clemson. Hell, Florida State, because their quarterback, Jordan Travis, or Travis Jordan, whatever his name is, tore his knee, got effed up. They couldn't even get into it, and they got screwed out of it. So how are you going to say it's a Florida team? The ACC preferential is always going to be Clemson. And I would not be surprised if we match with the same amount of losses, Clemson would trump over us.
Is that really it, Andrew? That's really the big bad thing that's happening to college football right now? It was just that the Miami's
You didn't say what was the big bad. You said what was the most controversial.
Okay, well, that is controversial. What's the big bad thing happening right now?
Not necessarily it's bad, but we had another huge amount of realignment.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that confuses me, man. I don't. Someone who just subscribes to professional sports, you know.
I'll try to break it down real quick. So next season, so the Big Ten and the Big 12 decimated the Pac 12. Pac 12 is down to 2 teams right now. You've got Oregon State, Washington State. They're no longer a P5 conference. They're basically a group of 5 conference right now. They're required to get up to 8 full member schools by 2026 in order to maintain eligibility of getting a team into the playoff if they're one of the highest ranked conference champions. So they made their first move on that. They poached Boise State, Fresno State, Colorado State, San Diego State, and Utah State from the Mountain West, which that means that all seven of their teams end in state. So you have Oregon State, Washington State, Boise State, Fresno State, Colorado State, San Diego State, Utah State. So it is functionally the blank state conference right now. They will all be joining in 2026. As a response to that, the Mountain West poached UTEP from Conference USA, the school from your favorite city, Francis.
Oh, yeah, good old El Paso.
So the Mountain West now needs one more team, one more full member in order to maintain that eligibility. Rumors are Hawaii, potentially. Hawaii is not a full member right now. They're only a member in, they're called an associate member. They're only a member in football. So that's a possibility. Some people think they may bring up a team from FCS. The Mountain West is locked in when it comes to teams defecting. No one else is defecting. The remaining teams banded together. They're staying put. So the pack, honestly, everyone and their mother thinks that the two conferences should just merge at this point. I don't know why they have it. You know, keep the Pac-12 name, but bring on the Mountain West management or whatever. I don't know. Because the Pac-12 has the more recognizable name. It is complicated and it's very stupid. So we'll see what happens with that. But that was a flurry of moves that happened in the span of a week or two, within the past month. So we'll see how that plays out going forward. I think that's really kind of the last big college football news. Aside from Alabama losing, Tennessee lost. There were five of the top 11 teams lost last week. Alabama, Tennessee, Missouri. Gosh, who else lost? It was a very upset friendly week last week, and it supposes to continue because I don't know, things just be crazy this year.
Okay, so we're at 1 hour and 38 minutes. Charles, you want to hop on board the petty train? We go through the NFL.
Yeah, it might be pertinent, yes.
Yeah, so NFL scores. I watched the Dolphins and Patriots game. I thought I was going to get what I was going to get, but unfortunately, a call was brought back. We thought the guy had 2 feet in, and apparently when you get 2 feet in, you can drag your toes, but if you just plop one part of your bottom foot and the heel isn't in, it's still out of bounds. So I did not know that. I still feel like that's kind of cheap. I think if you get your foot in, you get your foot in. I don't care how you get it in. You know what I mean? But you know what? That's the NFL, and then it was in a game that's non-consequential to anybody, which is the Dolphins and the Patriots. So, but whatever. The Dolphins barely won, but they won 15-10. Fine. Aside from that, Falcons and Buccaneers game.
That was good.
Yeah.
I watched it.
Bucks have the chances, man. They have the shots. But in any case, let's see. We've got... how about this? Your good old boy, Aaron Rodgers, Charles. Vikings. Okay. Jets, 23-17, Minnesota.
I'm stuck in Georgia traffic.
Aaron Rodgers.
Listening stats. To this man. Listening to this man just choke it out, which led consequently to Robert Saleh's departure, which I actually don't blame Rodgers for being fired. I think Woody Johnson's a tool, because if you ever looked at how he did things, he screams tool. You know, your Johnson & Johnson products are subpar, and so is your ownership of this team. But it just feels good, man, because my biggest hate on Aaron Rodgers, what, we've been doing this for 6 years, and I remember when I brought it out to you guys, you were like, this is a dirty little secret of how I think Aaron Rodgers is actually not good. He's going to get into the Hall of Fame. It's indisputable. He got one Super Bowl ring and four MVPs. But I think we fell in love with him being like Mr. Hail Mary a couple times to really not like see that he's, I'm going to say it, super unreliable as a player with injuries and then just not coming to crunch time. And you can blame on coaches all you want. I don't know. Like, I'm not a player. I'm not even a player, but he's just not likable. And this is even before he began his whole ayahuasca conspiracy stuff. I just never thought he was sexy. And my bitterness, I'll be the first person to tell you, comes from the fact that his fourth MVP came on the season that Derrick Henry had 2,000 yards rushing plus whatever came from his receiving. And what was actually valuable, because that's impressive as an individual set. And MVP is treated as an individual set. And yeah, he didn't have many picks. It was like 40 touchdowns and what, like 6 interceptions. I don't care. Like, I think it's something special when running back hits 2,000 yards, because there's a very limited amount of players who actually do that in comparison to like a quarterback who throws multi-touchdowns. And he didn't go anywhere with it, man. Like, it was just infuriating and made me lose my steam. But seeing him on his decline, and I'm going to pivot to Saleh getting fired for a second. I actually thought Saleh was a bad coach in general. Mm-hmm. I understand people tell me that he has a good defensive team, but like, defense is defense and winning games matters. And for this season alone, the teams that you beat, including myself, were not competent teams. So when you played a seminal, like important team, like the Niners, you shat the bed. And the Vikings are not the greatest team, but it just goes to show there was more problems itself. So I think his firing was more of the body of work, but this is basically like a doomsday device going on for Rodgers, that this is how you're going to end your career, because I don't know if the fire of these coaches actually make a difference. But it helps. You know, the thing is, it feels like on the high, because, you know me, I'm petty. I knew Francisco was going to talk about this, fellas. Like, I watched the YouTube throws. It seems like he throws these balls the same way that he expected past teammates, Jordy Nelson, Randall Cobb, Devontae Adams, would catch them, to guys like Garrett Wilson, Alan Lazard, and Mike Williams. And that's not necessarily the case. And it's just there. I feel very good. I feel very good at my state of hate of Aaron Rodgers. And, you know, this is not an attack of the man, even though I do think it's very suspect that his insecurity showed that after his coach was fired, he had to go on to Pat McAfee. I like Pat McAfee as a wrestler. I have no as a wrestling component, I have no shame to say that I think he's a tool of ESPN just to get the college bros to be relevant, plain and simple, for the guys who have two brain cells and they think that Bud Light and Coors Light are the best beers in mankind. There's some stuff that's really showing from there, but I feel good about it. This is a good season for Charles. My team is ass, 7, but my hate for Aaron Rodgers, I've never been more wrecked.
Okay. Let's see. Let me go down the list again.
Y'all know I how it is with me and that man.
I get it. I understand. The Bears spanking the Panthers.
Fine, whatever. I still don't see what the difference between Caleb Williams versus Justin Fields.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't see the difference.
Let's see. The Washington has won again. They beat Cleveland.
Dan Quinn. We talk about Jaden Daniels, but this is not Dan Quinn's redemption arc. For like, he will always be remembered for the Patriots loss, but you know, he's going to show that he was actually a damn good coach to begin with. Mm. So good for him. This is the one few times where recidivism actually matters. Good for him, dude.
Yeah. In comparison to the recidivism of Deshaun Watson. That, so.
Well, Deshaun, but also like of other coaches that we see throughout the years. Eric Mangini comes to mind.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we're old enough where we can talk about it.
Let's see. The Jaguars beat the Colts.
I just want to chime in on something really quick.
By all means, sure.
The Jaguars need to go back to that old look.
Yeah, good uniform.
It's so much better. It is. And Charles, I know that you had mentioned that, you know, who really cares about how a team looks?
Well, you know my personality, so I think you're right.
I mean, yes, you are right. I would prefer, if push came to shove, a team that plays like look at the Tampa Bay Lightning. I hate the way they look. Their uniforms are so boring. You call them the Toronto Red Wings or the Detroit Maple Leafs. I don't know, because that's literally what their uniform is. It's the Red Wings uniform in blue. That is literally what it is. The only difference is there are barely noticeable accents of black and then the lightning bolt on the pants. That's literally it. It is so fucking boring.
Remember, you have to count your cursing, so I'm giving you one, not that one.
What's that? Oh, right.
We track cursing. We've been doing that for, what, 2 seasons now?
Yeah.
Okay, so it is very, very boring.
Yanks up 2.
That's the same. That said, we did win 2 Stanley Cups wearing those very, very boring uniforms. I am not all of a sudden saying, I would prefer we be in nice uniforms versus, no. We won those cups. I prefer those cups over I would prefer success over looking good. That said,
I got them baby blues for the Titans, but I understand.
But that said, ¿por qué no los dos? Why can't we have both? Mm. Why can't we look good and play good?
My boy speaks Spanish now.
Yeah, he does. Well, so you know me about the Marlins.
Exactly. The Marlins, well, they're not really that.
Byproduct.
The Marlins are in really bad shape because they are neither playing good nor looking good. That is hell.
That's defamatory up in this house.
I don't think he would disagree with me, though.
I mean, they don't look awful in these uniforms. It's just that they don't look right in these uniforms.
I mean, listen.
They don't look right in the way they are right now. But in comparison,
if the Marlins had just begun as a franchise, or maybe their first uniform was the ones that they use in the end of the Loria era. I think this would be a vast improvement. They're not bad uniforms.
Right.
But when you have I prefer like the 97 look when there's a little more black added to it. I think the 93 version is a little too teal for my liking. But even if you went with the 93 version, it is infinitely better than what they're wearing right now. That's the problem. You have the history of a really, really good look, and you're choosing not to go with it, even though that is what everyone and their mother wants. Kind of like with the Jacksonville Jaguars. Their current uniforms are extremely bland. It's teal and black. That's it. This old set that they used as a throwback, and they're actually bringing back this week, has a little more black in it, and it has gold. It looks different. It has a little more pop to it. Kind of like with the Rays. Their kind of throwish back look, I think, is better than what we're wearing right now as our primaries. That said, they're not bad. I would say that they're better. The current look is better than what the Marlins have. That's just me. But if they were to go back to the 98 look, I would be very excited about that because they look a lot better. There was that period in the mid 2000s to the mid 2010s, like that 10-year period, kind of like what we're seeing with logos now, where simple is the name of the game. Mm-hmm. It just looks awful. You spice things up a little bit. You see kind of things looping back around. Burger King went back to its old logo. You see a couple of companies that are ditching the oversimplified version, saying, you know what, maybe we had it right the first time. The Marlins had it right the first time. The Devil Rays had it right the first time. The fact that they're choosing not to go back to these is just criminal in my mind. And again, I preface this all by saying I would rather a team that looks bad but is really good versus a team that is really good, really bad but looks really good. But again, ¿por qué no los dos?
All right.
Okay.
Let's see. And then let's see. I'm going to just run down the gamut here. We're at 151. It's going up. Oh, I was in the other week. Texans beat the Bills.
Eh. So I'm helping my buddy on his you guys fantasy. Know Charles McGee and his fantasy. And like it's kind of like a conflux of things. And we have Stefan Diggs in our join league. We should rename the team. McGee, if you hear me, like we should name the team like C2C for Charles, you know, 2 squared, because his name's Charles as well. But the Texans give me faith that the AFC South is not lost. That's all I could say. The Bills give me faith that the AFC East is trash.
Yeah. Yeah. The Dolphins are still in it.
Jesus Christ, man. Seriously.
Seemed like a runaway division. Yeah.
Right? Everybody's still in it when it should.
Now it's like Tua might get healthy in time. You know? Who knows?
He should not be playing.
But the, you know he will. The Ravens beat the Bengals in a wild game.
Right. I looked at those stats. I wish I could watch it live. But Joey B.
The end was insane. I actually did watch that. The overtime.
Listen, if the Titans, you know, I'm here to support Derrick Henry.
Oh yeah.
So like, of course,
and
I just
he
won.
Of course led that drive at the end.
He's a beautiful man. I don't think he'll ever know. Like Bette Midler, you are the hero beneath my wings. It's you, dog. It's you. Like straight up for 9 years, it was you. I will cry if they win. I want them to win it because I care about him more than I care about my entire team. This might be 2 years figure. I actually don't hate the team I have. That's only because when I saw them live, they won. But it's all for him. It's all for you, Derek. It's all for you. I got two great Derek's in my life. My paralegal and my former running back. That's it.
Let's see. What else do we have?
That's beautiful, man. That's beautiful.
It is. We've got Broncos beat the Raiders. Broncos are 3-2, by the way.
My buddy Sheldon and Afro, they're Broncos fans, so good for Bo Nix. He actually seems competent. He's one of those rookie quarterbacks who understands the assignment as opposed to trying to make plays. And you know what? Knowing your role and shutting your mouth, to quote The Rock. More on that later. Like, a little forewarning there, kids. Can play a big, big impact in football.
All right. Let's see. Continuing on here, we've got the Cardinals beating the 49ers.
Meh. Battle of crap at this point. Good for Kyler, but you know I don't like Kyler. I don't hate him as a person. Call of Duty. I'll lock up with you, bro. But still.
Packers beat the Rams.
It's not even fair at this point. Like, I love Matt Stafford to a degree, but when he doesn't have weapons and he's old, good for the Packers, everybody who's a Packer fan. So Jordan Love, sure, but
Giants beat the Seahawks. Yeah. The Chiefs beat the Saints. Yeah. And the Cowboys beat the Steelers. That's because you know the thing NFL is, analysis, baby.
a lot of the guys that you just brought up are on the fantasy team, and there's no baby vessels like last time. And my buddy, because he's a Cowboys fan, picked Dak, and I'm like, I would not pick Dak if my life fucking depended on it. It's eight. So it's tough because like Geno or Dak this week, I'm like, don't do Geno. But this is what I'll say about the Cowboys. Last year, I felt there was confidence. This year, it feels like it's just like the best of the best circumstances if you have out of a bad situation. And that's how I feel about the entire NFC East, even in Washington. And like with the Steelers, I just can't hate Mike Tomlin. I think he's an outstanding human being. And to say that about a coach who the NFL doesn't really produce a lot of guys that you like, but like at the end of the day, when my team is bad at 1-3, when I have to watch other football games, I want teams that excite me. And the last 3-4 games that you just mentioned, aside from the Ravens Bengals, are just really like the worst thing. Like if you brought somebody from Yugoslavia, if they're still in existence, and said, hey,
it's not, the country's not, but
well, that's a good point though. Bring somebody from that when Yugoslavia was in existence, and you said, hey, watch this game. Those teams that you mentioned would make me like, you like this game? And that's it.
All right. Okay, that's the NFL. All right, so we did name this episode The Charlo Goes Down to Georgia. So I feel like it's fitting for us to end on it. I mean, we usually would start with it, but I guess this time we did it. Because like last time you went to the Trop, right? For a show, and we had like a whole, the whole theme of the show was for that. But here we are, was it Bad Blood, right? So
yeah,
I'm getting ready. Because you did send us photos. You did actually type to us in the text that the Charlo has come. And I, you know, sent you
Charlo stuff was from, alive
stuff from Alan Wake, because I kind of feel like he's your Mr. Scratch, but yeah,
he really is, goddamn.
But
here's the thing.
Yeah,
I have to interrupt. We didn't talk about my coup, and I have to talk about.
Oh, that's right. We didn't talk gaming in this one. That's right. All right, let's go.
Yeah, but I have to explain to you the coup.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're gonna hate me.
Oh boy, you bought an Xbox Series X, didn't you?
So, I have Ramona. And Ramona is the root of all my problems. She is my Helen of Troy. I launched 1,000 ships for her. She's the reason why I brought the PlayStation. And when we started the season, what did we start the season on? The PS5 Pro.
Yeah, that's true. We did talk about that.
And as you know, I have $335 in trading credit. I had a $50 gift certificate for one of my friend's birthday. Love you, Steven. I had my nephew give me a $25 gift card for my birthday. So I had a total of $410. And I look on the Twitter, and I see Cheap-Ass Gamer, follow him on the Twitter for sure.
Oh, fantastic. Saying that,
fantastic. It says that PS5 Pros were available already at Best Buy and GameStop. So I went on Best Buy first, and I said, yeah, you know what? I'm going to get $30 in a trading credit on this. I'm going to do it. And I did it. But I have to tell you how this top seat. This is all in the morning, right before I became a lawyer, man. I said, but you know what? I have $410 in trading credit. What am I going to do? So I canceled my Best Buy trading credit. And this was my logic. Francisco,
okay.
I'm sick of letting my Ramona have subpar performance. I am sick of having choose between performance mode and fidelity mode. I've had this beautiful console and this beautiful television. My PS5 has done nothing wrong. It's done nothing wrong. But I'm sick of having to say, hey, do I want 1080p or 1440p or 60fps? Or do I want to go 30fps with ray tracing? I made an executive decision. You know me. Listen, I'm Argentinian Colombian. The Argentine gets that loud mouth, brazen, like, fuck it, I'll go. Fuck it, we ball 10. That is the Argentine. The Colombian is the mathematics. I looked at it mathematically. Like, I was running that Coke, right? Hopefully my bosses never hear me say it. And I made that decision. I said, you know what? Because I didn't do the mid-grade generation update for the PS4 to the PS Pro. PS4 Pro because I didn't need to. I didn't have 4K TV. It was not readily accessible. Had I not had an OLED television, I would not even contemplate this idea. I didn't Kid Icarus this stuff. You know what I did? I owed this, basically. I said, I'm going to shape this world, build it, and go from there in all intents and purposes. I'm going to give some life to it. And I canceled my Best Buy because my GameStop was available. And for those who don't know, and we talked about it, and I understand it's bougie, but it's only bougie if you don't have what is available to you. I have what is available to me. The PS5 Pro is going to have some new AI that's going to put native scaling 4K. It's going to have some natural upgrades in there. I have a bunch of a backlog that's available. Really, the only thing I have to get is a disk drive, which I do disagree with Sony for doing that. But you know what? Beggars can't be choosers. I'll put it on the Best Buy card. But the price was $745. But what do you guys know about me? I'm going to put GameStop out of business. I promise you, it is going to happen. So let me tell you how I'm going to put this company out of business. I canceled my Best Buy. I went on to GameStop. I'm like, oh, word, girl? Because this was going to be different. This ain't a Switch 2. This ain't a new Xbox. You know it's only going to be selected to certain people because the PS5 Pro only works for people who have an OLED. You have an OLED, Francisco. You understand what it means. If I did not have an OLED and I had a general 4K, and 4K is fine, guys. I'm telling you right now. The OLED is really going to give you black as the blacks, the white as the whites, full color spectrum, and give you the ability to have variable refresh rate at 120 FPS. If that matters to you, that matters to you. It mattered to me because at the end of the day, I didn't want to play Lake House at 1080p at 60 FPS. I couldn't do it, man.
Yeah.
I couldn't do it anymore. I'm sick of it. I saw it once at beautiful ray tracing, and I said, ah.
When
I was collecting trophies, I said, hey, what if I got this at 60 FPS at ray tracing? And it's going to give me that. So, I had $335 in trading credit. I have $50 in gift card for one friend. I had $25 for my nephew, who's 17. It's beautiful. I just love him so much. I had $410. So, on GameStop. I had to verify this. I had to make sure. I said, what is going to be my PS5 trade-in amount if I'm a pro member? Me, my nephew, my brother-in-law, Sherry. And they said it's going to be $300. Like, oh, bet. Okay. But I want you to understand why this console is so expensive. The console is $700. But guys, you want to know why it's expensive? It's not because of all the bells and whistles. It's a very simple solution. When you buy a PlayStation 5, if you buy it right now, the internal memory is only 667 SSD internal. The internal memory of a PS5 Pro is 2 terabytes. I have a 1 terabyte expansion already in my PS5 Pro right now. I can put on that internal add-on to make it to 3 terabytes. And you know what? I'll be the first person to tell you, I hate the internal storage of the PS5. I've never talked bad about my PS5 for 3 years. I'm going to talk bad about it right now. I hate the fact that I only have 667. Why wouldn't you just make it 1 terabyte? Everything's so expensive. Everything's so big, game-wise, too. So I have to go pay a big price, a premium for a new SSD, and then I have to get these games like Call of Duty, Madden, MLB, The Show, NBA, NHL. They're all so high. Alan Wake's 90 gigs, man. But I look at this PS5 Pro. I'm like, all right, I can add this on. I can make it into a 3 terabyte, which is huge. Nominal. You know this. I get a 4th controller out of it. I have an OLED. I have a 302 credit. I said, you know what? Let's do it. Let's just do it. F it. We're going to do it live. The total amount that I'm getting for this PlayStation 5 Pro. And this is for everybody, but you have to know the right place, right time, the situation, and you know how to con game. This thing is only cost me $345. So I put on the credit card, and I have points on my credit card because I always forget to use it for traveling. So November 10th, it's going to come out, or November 7th, it's come out. I'm going to get that, and I'm going to get it for like pennies on the dime because the cost of it, the way I looked at it.
Fucking A.
Yankees are up 3-0.
Barkov just went into the boards real hard, and
he's
shit.
Injured. Well, my nipples are hard because I see it's at 3-0 at the top of the six.
Oh, this is a leg injury. Shit. Oh, he might have shattered something. All right, sorry.
Well, that's all right. Well, let me give you the pride and joy here. So this thing's 345, so it's not even the 700. And mind you, like, there's some things I have to get the digital drive, but that's fine. I'll use my Best Buy credit card onto it. But the beauty of it all is that the plan was always to get the Switch 2 for free. Consoles had a different rule. You guys know this, but the plan was always to get Switch 2 for free. But $300 on a trade-in for my PS5 Pro, and when I get it, I'll just transfer whatever I have to transfer, go from there, plus whatever residual Switch games I have, like Peach, which I'm playing right now, a couple other games too. Mm. We're gonna be back to square one. We're not even at zero. We're gonna be back to square one. So I have somehow, in my mind, not the heist, but the coup, of getting that PS5 Pro for a totality of like $180 more than originally I paid for my PS5, which is worth it because of Ramona. And I get a fourth controller. Fantastic. I have three whites. I don't know what to do with them. Call me the Brady Bunch. But now the thing is, what did we talk about game one? We said, hey, this is gonna put everything, like all the games gonna be in mass production. And I looked at the list and I was gonna send it to you guys, but wait. What games are already said to be enhanced, and I have four or five games that are in waiting if that's going to be on the PS5 Pro enhanced. And you know what, guys? I know, and I watch Digital Foundry. You guys should follow them if you want to see some real smart tech people talking. If you want to have 60 FPS with high ray tracing, which is anybody who has a PC, really. It's you, man. It's you with all the CPU and the GPU that you're talking about.
I just paid for a CPU. So I
committed the coup because it's going to be a way where I get this console at a very discounted rate, and then I get back to having everything I invested into it for my Switch 2 funding back to where I can get that Switch 2 free, because that's not coming out till November 2025. That's my guess.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're telling me I was able, and it's all from GameStop. It's not going from Best. I was okay with Best Buy for a second, because that's the first one that got me on the pre-order line. I didn't think GameStop would have it. I'm like, oh, hey, man, you're good. I'm like, oh, okay. Oh, my God. Oh, man. And then it happened. And I'm like, well, I'm going to cancel this and go for that. So this might be my greatest achievement, that I was able to use OPP, other people's, you know, money, basically. OPM, I guess. OPP is a song from back in the day. We will say it here for the cleanliness. Sorry, Tipper Gore, you won't get us with your censoring. But OPM of other people's money, I am super excited. I'm sorry. I'm a cuck, as my buddy said, for doing this 100%. But I have the television for it. And let me tell you something. We're all going to die one day. We've dealt with some losses going on right now in this household. But you know what? If I'm going to go, let me go. I'm the flashiest, the fastest, and the fanciest of this bitch.
Yeah.
So I was able to do it. So that was my big announcement. I think you guys knew, knowing me. This is why I could never have a computer.
Is it here? Do you have it yet, right? Or no?
It comes out November 7th.
Oh, that's
so
right.
So between that 1-3 okay, ratio. Right. And so here's the game that I know I'm waiting on. Because remember, I told you the post-Cyberpunk was going to be Princess Peach and Astrobot. And I sent you a little picture in the chat of Sonic. I was playing Princess Peach already.
Mm-hmm.
But Astrobot will be the first gameplay, because I almost believe that Sony has a PS5 Pro upgrade ready for it. And I'm gonna play that. You know I'm gonna play Spider-Man 2 again. You know I'm gonna play Ragnarok again. I have Final Fantasy 16 going on. Madden 25 isn't even a PS5 Pro enhanced. I'm gonna get Liza P. And the way I looked at it, I was like, man, I already have things down the line, because the PS6 is not coming out. So another 5-6 years is my guess. This is perfect timing. I could not be happier. So that was the coup of the day. So
good
job. That was the devil. That was the Charlo in Florida. Mm. But now we can go into the next segment. So,
yeah, and like, I bought a PC CPU upgrade that should be coming. I guess this weekend. Give or take some stuff with the weather. So
what a perfect segue. Dirty.
Yeah, so I'm getting ready for the lake house as well, Charles.
I have to delay lake house because Alan Wake 2 is actually getting the upgrade. Spooky season got screwed over.
Yeah, this month's I mean, look, I could wait until until you get your PS5. That way we can both go in on it at the same time, right? So that's fine. I don't mind. I'll get the CPU upgraded there. Have some fun with that. It'll actually be the first time we'll be upgrading this CPU here. I haven't really opened it for those purposes yet, so it'll be an interesting endeavor for me. And I just don't want my games to be choppy no more, Charles. That's what
I thank you. Thank you. You want 60 FPS or higher with ray tracing capabilities.
Exactly. So, and right now, no, the graphics card is good enough.
PS5 Pro is still available, so I'm sending you that link.
Yeah, and Andrew still won't let me get at that gaming PC that he's got, because he's got one too, and he could live like us. So, all right. So, I think it's time we hear about the Charlo going down to Georgia, so it's time to head over to the cage.
Oh, man. Welcome, everybody, to your weekly Truplex The Cage with Charles. Full disclaimer, wrestling is not fake. It's scripted. It's a stage fight. It's song and dance. It's poetry in motion. It's a soap opera when you want to be a soap opera. It's about men and women being the holy hell of each other, chasing championships and establishing their legacy. So the Charlo went down to Georgia, and he was looking for a soul of steel. And I brought a storm back to Florida. I have no sex appeal when it comes to him. So sorry. A lot of stuff happened in Georgia. And I'm going to give some shout-outs beforehand to the places that I ate at and what I had to eat.
All right.
Right?
Yeah, I can get the big screen going, too, with that.
Yeah, so the first and foremost, because I ate at multiple places, it was my first experience in Georgia. I've driven through it, but I never actually ventured there. So what I can say about the great state of Georgia and the city of Atlanta is that y'all motherfuckers nine know how to make chicken and bacon.
Yeah.
Straight up. No yeah. play.
Some
no
good
lie.
Stuff over there.
Hands down, and I had no hankering or preference. I just knew that I needed to get this in. I'm telling you right now, this cage is all about WWE. If my son of Twang comes out, it's because I'm really feeling it. You know, it was some good stuff coming in. So we're gonna talk about food first. First thing, I went on Friday with my boy Tony and his wife. We went to Lazy Dog restaurant, and I sent to you guys a PB&J burger. Delicious. Right. It had consisted
Lazy Dog in Dunwoody, Georgia.
Dunwoody, Georgia.
All right, let's go. All right, and here we go.
It was delicious because you guys know me. I'm going to try weird stuff. I don't want the basics. Mm. The basics can be done, but I want the weird stuff. And I saw that PB&J because I've had peanut butter burgers before. And I always thought they're kind of good. Jelly, not so much. So this is my thoughts. That is 8.5 burger because the meat was cooked very properly. The bacon was solid. I went lettuce and tomatoes. I forgot to take out the tomatoes, but didn't hurt it. The jelly, when I bit into it, plopped out a little bit. So I was like, what are we here for? But the peanut butter, the way they did it is they kind of like, I don't want to say sauteed, but they spread it on each bun. So it gave you both that kind of like, you know, the burger meat with the peanut butter flavoring. And it was just heaven. It was so good. And I had the cheddar biscuits as well. And I was like, man, it was just so good. Definitely recommend. They have other varieties of food. Their fish and chips look very good. Loved it. The next day, because we went to Bad Blood, boys. We went to Bad Blood. More on that in a second. But this is a food review that's coming. My complaint about Georgia, though, y'all roads suck. Why is everything like a very long one-way street? I had to take the monumental U-turn to get back onto the expressway. It sucked. Food, though, delicious. The next day, before it was a Bad Blood, we went to Hudson's Park and Grill. That's where I had those wings that I sent you. I had hot lemon pepper. What does that mean, Charles? The wings are drenched in hot sauce with lemon pepper put onto it. And the other half that I had was sweet and spicy. Both good. Sweet and spicy was kind of
where were
like
we at? Hold on. Where were we at?
Hudson Grill.
Hudson Grill. In Atlanta?
Yes.
I'm going to just type that in and see what we get here. Hudson Grill, Midtown Atlanta. Okay. Let's go.
So I had the wings. You know, we share them. I had fries. We had the hot lemon pepper and sweet spicy. It's affordable. It's a good family restaurant. A little delayed in, like, the service, but whatever, right? I can live with it. We were trying to kill, like, 3 hours, so it's understandable. Gave that. Nice little 7.5 out of 10 because of service. Food wise, the wings, we ate them all. 20 wings spread between us and fries. And then we had
I see the wings here. Here we go.
Oh, the wings were so good. The appetizer, mozzarella sticks. They were flattened mozzarella stick, which was interesting, but very tasty. I kind of think about it, you know, going at night, because when you make a good wing, so you ask yourself, Charles, what is a good wing? A good wing is one that has a good amount of flavor breaking the skin and has succulent meat when you eat it, whether it be a flat or a drum, whatever the hell you like, whatever works for you. Fries were fries. They were like crinkle fries, but they had other stuff of interest. The liquor, it was okay. You know, it was okay. I wasn't trying to get like Charlo level in Carolina from last year because I actually need to watch the game, but more on that in a second. But I would say it's worth your time. It's right by the State Farm Arena, so you should just pop up, sit down, enjoy your food. We watched some college football. It was enjoyable. Went to Bad Blood. After, right before Bad Blood, we went to Parkside Bar. I'm only going to talk about this for a second because I didn't eat there. I was still full for my time.
Man, I got to tell you, I like downtown Atlanta, man.
I like Atlanta, man. I liked it.
It's a good spot, man. I'm telling you. And I've been there, and you guys know I've been to Atlanta tons of times, so yeah.
The people are polite, the food are good, it is something that is tasty, but we went to Parkside Bar and Grill right beforehand because we had to walk around. I bought a shirt, you know, I had to buy some OTC, it was good. I go to get a drink, I'm like, what drink do you want? I'm like, let me get a Long Island, and they go and say the most magical words I ever heard in my life. And I said, all right, do you want a single or do you want a triple for the price of a double? Holy crap. We already know. I was like, triple. So me and my boy are getting it. And his wife's like, nah. And I'm like, ah, man. It was good. It was well priced. I don't want to say how much I spent there, but we did that and we did some car bombs. Mm. And then we went on. And then after the event, we went to Meehan Irish Pub, where I had a very good buffalo wrap. Meehan, M-E-E-H-A-N.
Yeah.
Thumbs up. The waiter was attentive. I tipped him well. It was good because we're coming out of an event. There's a lot of walking distance that happens in downtown Atlanta.
Downtown Atlanta is, it's a walking distance, but it's a pretty walkable part of the city.
It's walkable.
Things are nearby. You have the Olympic Park
there.
We
were there, yes. And we were at the Olympic Park.
Yeah, everything's kind of nearby. You have the University of Georgia State University is around there. But
I went to the aquarium.
Yeah, the aquarium's right there. Coca-Cola, all that stuff. So there's a lot of restaurants and things nearby. It's a nice little setup. Like you can stay there and you can pretty much hit up some pretty good bars and restaurants and things like that around the things that you want to hang out at around there, which is, you know, Falcons, Mercedes-Benz Stadium, and the State Farm Arena.
And what I tell people is that whenever I travel, I don't go for the drinks. That stuff's the same stuff I can buy at my liquor store. It's about the food because I don't cook that well. So it's like, all right, let me get that. Mm-hmm. So Meehan was good. And then for breakfast, you know, we went to another cracked egg cafe and I had some of the best chicken waffles I ever had. The waffles were just like average because like how sexy can you make it unless you put toppings on it? But they had fried tenders at the end of the cracked egg cafe. And it was just so good. And they had a picante sauce that worked well with their bourbon jam. The food overall in Georgia, I got to say, you Georgians, Atlanta or not, you know how to make your chicken. Mm. You know how to make your waffles. If I ever go back there, and I could. The drive wasn't terrible. I just listened to audiobooks like the Cimarillo, and I finished up Shauna May going out there and coming back. It is worth it like for the adventure of the food. So it's not bad. Bad Blood. So this is a WWE exclusive. I have nothing for you in AEW. This is what I'll say about AEW. Wrestle Dream this Saturday. Would I buy it? Sure. Am I going to buy it? Obviously not. I have to save some money. I spent a lot this weekend and last weekend. But Bad Blood. I got to tell you guys, it was a different experience to the Royal Rumble. I think I enjoyed the Royal Rumble just a little bit more because the booking and the matches were better. But I think I had almost better seats. We were like section 118 instead of the floor. Because remember, my mistake with the Royal Rumble was that you're going to an event that had an over-the-top concept where people get thrown over the top and there might be people in front of you. But I like the seats that me and my boys were able to get. I bought a OTC, a Roman Reigns shirt. I have four Roman Reigns shirts. Why am I like this, right? I'm just like I'm just like piggybacking and meat riding at its hardest degree.
I've got the the WWE site up on the screen here with the nice rundown of what happened. So, I mean, we can go down this list to help you out, Charles, or what?
Well, so I'm going to kind of gauge you a little bit.
Yeah.
You don't realize how much you need to watch on television with the commentary and the camera angles more than in person. Because in person, you're really just watching the match and you're hearing the crowd. You're not getting the commentary from Michael Cole, Corey Graves, to really amp your blood up a little bit. So I will rewatch this in the coming week to get the full effect. I will say I was satisfied because when we bought the tickets, we were originally going to do WrestleMania 41 at Vegas. But I was like, I don't know how rich I'm going to be at that time because WrestleMania is a two-night event, right? And it could really, like, because you got to pay for the rooms, you got to do all this stuff and going from there. So I'm going to talk to you guys about, like, the matches I saw and then the need of, like, rewatching it on there. Overall, it was a great experience. Atlanta was hot. It was ready. The first match was CM Punk versus Drew McIntyre in Hell in a Cell. CM Punk won that match. It was good from what I saw it at. But that is the match I need to rewatch on Peacock. Because I heard it was fantastic from a television aspect of it. Why? Because you can get close-ups on people bleeding. You can hear the commentary of Michael Cole and Corey Graves amp you up. You hear certain sound effects. But from the match that I saw, it was very good. Charlo was not in there yet. He was coming a little bit. He came a little bit later. But we were not Ultra Instinct level because I knew I wanted to watch this. Last year when I went Ultra Instinct Charles at the Panthers Saints game, I didn't care about either team. Both of them sucked. Why would I want to be sober for that, right? This one, where I had some vested interest, I did care. So that's the match I'm going to rewatch, but I do think it was the best match of the night. Nia Jax versus Bayley, that was fine. I liked it. I didn't hate it. I liked that. I should have said CM Punk beat Drew McIntyre, for those who don't know, going from there. And then Nia beat Bayley in a decent amount of that. I thought it was a good match. The next match, Damian Priest versus Finn Balor, it was good. It was short. You could tell they were kind of doing the taster of it. So you're going to get another feud out of it. And Priest beat Balor. That's fine. Rhea Ripley versus Liv Morgan for a match that's been really been building up throughout the entire year was just not what I want to be. I hate saying that matches suck. You guys know me. I support what? The workers. I don't support the company. But they've done a really piss poor job of building it. Dominic was held up into a cage. Raquel Rodriguez came out, helped Liv beat Rhea, and they botched that up a little bit as well because it ended a DQ when Rhea was supposed to have Liv pin her, and they're still continuing the feud. When I rewatch the pay-per-view, I will not be rewatching that match. That's all I have to say. The optics were there. The main event, I have to talk about this. I sent you guys a lot of photos. You saw a lot of like real-life Charles. The main event was Cody Rhodes and Roman Reigns versus Solo Sikoa and Jacob Fatu. Remember the stories that Roman had the original bloodline. He lost that mania to Cody Rhodes. They're teaming up. Solo Sikoa has his new bloodline with Jacob Fatu. Cody came out. The crowd was hot. Roman came out. The crowd was very hot. Charles believes that Cody has taken a backseat in his reign and should never have that with a main event. Side note, Gunther, Sami Zayn, and Bill Goldberg were in my pay-per-view as well because they were harping up a little bit of the Monday Night Raw match of Sammy versus Gunther, which was good. Gunther retained. So that was a nice little pleasant surprise. Goldberg is a, you know, Georgia native. So I was like, oh, damn. You know, I loved it. So I sent the picture to my paralegal because Derek's a big wrestling fan. And he's like, I hate you. I'm like, all for me, Derek. He's like, I hate you. So the match was a pretty standard tag team match. It wasn't really special. Cody and Roman retained. But what happens? As you're waiting, as you see in the production line, I'm like, I know The Rock. The Rock, Charles? Yeah. Dwayne Johnson? Yeah. The guy who's Black Adam, like, failed? Yeah. The score, former Miami Hurricane? Yeah, that guy. I knew he was coming. But when we bought these tickets back in July, I had no idea that he would actually be there. And I want you to understand, I got into wrestling in 1997. My first two wrestling toys were Stone Cold Steve Austin and The Undertaker. The Rock didn't really pop up until 98, 99. But you always liked The Rock. Everybody did that. If you smell, you call people a jabroni. You said SmackDown Hotel. You raise the eyebrow. You said, it doesn't matter what you think. And then I heard his music. And then in a weird situation, 9-year-old, 10-year-old Charles overtook 35-year-old Charles. And I was shouting and I was hollering at brothers. I felt like I had an out-of-body experience. I felt that the adrenaline and the nervous system of my body hit its maximum output. And I know I actually lost a moment of my own physical capabilities. I'm not even kidding. And I swayed back into my chair. To which Tony's like, are you okay, bro? Because I had peaked. I had short-circuited, for lack of a better word. Because what I tell you about wrestling, I've said this before, like it can have something that can be for the good of the present and has a relatability to the past. Because that's the thing about wrestlers. There's always a connection. Like if I saw Undertaker, I'd scream. He came back at me, right? So Cold Steve Austin, that's the stuff. But it was just such a great experience. And I think it's the only time in my life where I lost all complacence. Look, I have suffered in life. I have fell in love in life. I've cared about people. I've lost people. I've had great joy. I got PlayStation 5 Pro that's coming out, right? I got a Switch. I bought title belts. I passed the bar exam. I have Esquire to my name. Seeing this man, and I'll never give him the kudos of it. You know, the funny story about The Rock is when I was studying for the bar, you know, like back in 2016, he had an app like the Rock Clock. That's what it was, where you know how guys it was studying for the bar. You wake up at like six, seven in the morning and just go to it. Like he had a specialized alarm that was like motivational conversation. I won't drink a tequila. I'm sorry, Rock. That shit's gonna be trash. But I remember that. I remember the setting up to go to the bar and stuff like that. And I don't know this man. I don't have any connection to this man, but I remember the way I felt when I was a child. And I remember the way I felt as an adult seeing him come through on certain things. I never paid for a Rock movie except for Hobbs and Shaw, which was good. I was on a date. That was fine. Good time, right? But there was something about it that really, it all connected. And I think that is what Nirvana probably feels like for people who achieve the highest state as a Buddhist or anything else in between. That right there was the pinnacle for whatever the card is. And I will rewatch the card to view it, to appreciate the show. But that scene with The Rock coming out, and I sent you guys the videos. I will look fondly back on this.
I've got it playing in the background.
That was to appreciate not the show. That was to appreciate the moment. And life is just made up of moments, guys. Good moments, bad moments. And whatever I take from it, whatever it is of me that comes from it, I'm being there at that pay-per-view, seeing him, being in there, doing what I had to do, because I would not be able to accomplish it if I wasn't in the position I was now. The tickets were cheap enough. It's not always monetary, but you do need to have money, unfortunately, in this world to go there, experience moments, right? Because the game is rigged. But that was a moment that connected. And this is what I appreciate more about wrestling. Unless the Yankees win the World Series, that is the moment I'm going to appreciate here. We're connected, the present me with the past me. And as we get older, we fade away past from that, right? It's not that people change us. It's just we grow up to be different people. So if Aaron Judge, if you hear me right now, win the damn World Series, do the damn thing. Because I want to connect to, you know, 20-year-old Charles and 8-year-old Charles and 7-year-old Charles when we had that stuff. But this was an opportunity to connect that kid in Polk County, Florida, to this man at that point, Atlanta, Georgia, via, you know, Martin County, Florida. And it was probably one of the most special moments I have. And if the Charlo went down to Georgia, I didn't take the devil with me. I might have brought the storm, but I brought some good vibes with it. And that's how I felt. And that's what I got for you on this cage.
Aw. Ah, I felt warm and fuzzy after that one.
Getting verklempt.
Yeah. I mean, but how could you not, right? How could you not? It's as if you got to meet Dan Marino or that, or if you got to meet, I don't know really what Andrew likes, Mackenzie Milton, right?
Or Steven Stamkos, you know.
Steven Stamkos.
There you go.
But he's had success in the present so much more, so that's like, it's the tough part.
Yeah, so I want to call back that, to the old days.
Probably the best an analog for me would be Pudge Rodriguez.
Okay.
Yeah, there you go. That's a good example.
Yeah. All right. Well, we're going to leave it on that. Nice, Charles. Bye, everybody. That's it for me.
Night, everyone.
Take care.
Bye.